All right, hello everybody. It is Saturday, so that means it is another episode of the Jim Fear podcast for the sick fucks out there who actually follow this shit for whatever reason. I, of course, am JimFear138, and I am joined this week by my friend Wandering Scarecrow.
Yes. How's it going?
And he also has a YouTube channel, and it is linked in the description. You should all go subscribe. Be sure to watch the Soviet pasta thing that he did a couple of years back. It still fucking cracks me up. Crow has best Russian voice next to actual Russians.
I actually went through watching that again the other day, and it's just the adverts at the end. It's just like, visit Boris House of Vodka. Not really place or museum, just Boris drink too much vodka. Build house of
Boris. It was a very, very clever thing that you did. I'm sorry if I'm a little bit lackluster. It's been a rough couple of days at work. And last night, I do have some good news though. Thanks to Dimension Bucket, last night we managed to work out how to get the podcast on iTunes, and we got everything fixed, and we submitted the podcast. So once I get that confirmation email, everything will be fucking gravy. You guys will be able to go onto iTunes, and you'll be able to get this podcast, all my narrations, and all of the audiobooks on your iPhone. I'm going to work on getting it on, like, Stitcher and other pod thingies. So, we'll just have to see. We'll have to see how it goes. I'm a one-man show. I'm kind of building this on my own with help from friends. Like my good friend Crow, man. So how's it going today, man?
Surprisingly good, actually. I was freaking out because my car yesterday, my fucking car decided to start making these shit noises, grinding noises, when I was braking. And so first thing, of course, I do is I call up my mechanic and I'm just like, all right, I'm bringing the car in. I need you to fix it. It might be the brakes. I might have fucked it up. And then I decided to drive it for 3 more hours.
Because you're just a fucking genius.
Because my mum's gone into hospital and she needs, technically right now she's in physical rehab because she had a knee replacement.
Wait, they can
so,
replace
of course,
your knee?
So, going to stop me from going to visit. Yeah, she has a titanium
knee
now.
Oh, I
so
thought,
anyone
I thought
out
she
there
had
listening
a knee transplant.
Who wants...
My bad. I was like, holy shit, I didn't know they could do
no,
that.
No, 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 brand new knee
medicine.
But yeah, just like warning to anyone out there who wants to rob my mother, another just, apart from all the other shit she can do to you, she will now knee you in the balls with titanium.
It's gonna be cold in the winter. Well, I would say cold in the wintertime, but it's fucking Australia. Your country's either like temperate or on fire. So.
Yeah, no, no, no. We have five seasons in Australia. Autumn, spring, summer, winter, and fuck you. Are we in fuck you right now? Yes, we are. We're always in fuck you.
What about swooping season?
Oh, God, do not... Shit. Fucking, I hated swooping season as a kid because I'd have to ride my bike.
So that's actually a real thing. You're not... That's a fucking thing in Australia.
Yeah, no.
The birds will fucking attack you.
Yeah, in springtime, when they're all fucking horny as shit, they go out and just like any other mindless drones, so birds, most animals,
Democrats
chads,
and Republicans.
Basically, anyone with an IQ less than a potato will just like they'll swoop you if you get too close to their love nest. And as a kid, I used to get swooped a lot because I had to ride my bike through these wooded areas. So, of course, one day I'm just like, fuck this shit. Grab my spare helmet. I knew when one of these magpies was going to swoop me, and I just swung it backwards.
Yeah, seriously, like, what? Like the thing that confuses me about swooping season is why don't you just, like, carry a tennis racket around? Are the magpies endangered or something? Can you not fight back?
They're, They're not endangered, it's just kind of considered mean.
They're trying to peck your eyes out.
Exactly, but we figured out, and it's the greatest thing, for those who don't know, the greatest thing you can do during sweeping season is either wear an ice cream tub on your head to protect you, or wear sunglasses on the back of your head so it looks like you're
staring. Oh, so they just peck you in the back of your skull instead of your actual eyes.
Well, that's the thing. They won't swoop you if they think you're looking
those
at them.
Those birds are fucking
evil. That's the whole thing. Oh, fuck yeah, they're Australian.
I seriously don't know how y'all do it, man. Like 90% of the vegetation and just about 100% of the animals down there just will kill you if given the chance. I don't know why y'all live in that fucking environment, man.
Well, because fucking no one else
good
will.
Good point. Well, the Aborigines would. They did for a while. Yeah.
Like, the only thing tougher than an Australian is an Aboriginal Australian. Because they've done it a lot longer. Oh, God, but this, like, my favorite thing about Aboriginal culture is hearing the stories from what they call the dream time.
Okay, now I'm interested.
Which is, well, it's basically just all the mythic stories that every religion seems to have. Whereas instead of talking about Norse gods who created thunder and some poor Jewish bloke getting knocked up against a tree, they spoke about animals.
Oh, that's cool.
And two of my favorite stories that came out of the Dreamtime were the stories of the rainbow serpent and Tidlick, the giant frog.
All right, I'm very interested. Continue.
All right. So the rainbow serpent was basically the high god of Aboriginal culture, and I'm not, from what I remember, that is. If there are any Aboriginals listening to this, first of all, fucking why? Second of all, I don't know. I'm not a master of it. I just remember certain things from what I, what I've seen and heard. So the rainbow serpent, giant snake, of course, being Australian,
of course,
giant snake, created all the mountains and valleys and gorges of Australia by carving it out of the earth with his own body.
That's kick ass.
And so, yeah, and they praise the rainbow serpent. These Aboriginal tribes praise the rainbow serpent. Except that two brothers thought the rainbow serpent was up to something, so they snuck up to where he was on his mountain, and they climbed into his mouth because they wanted to accuse him. Because
that's smart.
Yeah.
The giant god snake. Let's crawl right into where it eats.
Mm. And when their father found out that apparently these boys were eaten by the rainbow serpent, they went. He gathered his men, the hunters, and they went up and killed the rainbow serpent, cut open his stomach, and two rainbow lorikeets were released from his stomach. And those were
that's
two boys.
That's fucking mind-blowing.
Mm. And there's tons of stories. There's so many good ones. But the other one of my favorite, the Tiddalik the Giant Frog, is so hilarious because it's such a kid's story. Basically, there was a frog one day named Tiddalik who was so thirsty that he drank. And he drank. And he drank every body of water in Australia until he was massively filled with all this gushing water, which meant that none of the other animals could have any water. So they all tried to get him to release the water, and he would not budge. And so, like, the kangaroo tried to make him laugh by hopping around. Didn't work. The echidna tried to make him open his mouth by spining him, but his hide was too thick. Until Mr. Old Wombat came plodding in. And he just plodded and he plodded and he plodded. And Tiddalik thought that his walking was so hilarious that he just started bursting with laughter and released all the water in his belly.
And that's how babies are made.
And that's how babies are made. And there was... There was a story on how the kookaburra got its laugh, and it's either from what I remember, the only one I can remember was the kookaburra, which is a kingfisher, biggest of the kingfishers, if I remember, was watching a snake creep up on a wagtail, which is a tiny black bird with a giant tail fin that would, you know, hop side to side so it wags around. And he's watching this snake and he's watching the wagtail. And he's just like, he's from, you know, just fucking, you know, making the really long story short. He's just like watching, just like, I'm going to go fucking get you, cunt. You're dead. Get a bit closer, get a bit closer. And he swoops down, grabs the snake and eats it. And then every time he remembers that snake being so fucking stupid, he laughs his ass off. That's about as all I remember from that story. I know there's probably more of it, but I'm just like, nah, that's how I'm remembering it, and that's how I'm telling the kids.
Speaking of Australia, did you hear the news? You know what news I'm talking about.
There's a lot of news. Is it the rhinos? Then no.
About AC/DC, man.
Oh, fuck, yeah, no, that's old news to us, but... The fact that the lead singer of AC/DC is going deaf or has gone deaf to the point where he can't be there anymore.
It's just so fucking sad, man. That's two singers that they've gone through at this point. Which goes to show you, kids, if you're going to be in a rock band, always wear your ear protection. Especially on stage.
Yeah, it's not the... The drugs won't kill you. The sex won't kill you. The
rock and roll is the really dangerous part. That's why it comes last in the equation. But did you hear who they're replacing him with? Yeah.
Axl Rose?
Like, that is the strangest fucking choice. Like, I could even see them getting some new guy who's, like, not even really on the rock scene anymore. But Axl Rose is, like, in his 50s. He's all, like, fat now and everything. I've never even heard him sing AC/DC before.
Well, that's the thing. If, like, I spoke to this about, you know, Wandering Scarecrow Senior, my dad. I spoke to him about it, and we were coming up with so many people who could do it, and the names that came up with, you know, Keith Richards.
Is like fucking 200 years old, dude.
No. It's just about the voice. Keith Richards, Mick Jagger. Ozzy Osbourne.
Ozzy's fucking... Like, well, voice, yeah, probably, but, like, his personality would clash too bad with Angus.
But the name that we always came back to is Jimmy Barnes, the lead singer of Cold Chisel. Because if you Cheap One, Three Day Growth?
I don't listen to much new music.
No. No, this guy is old school. Like, yeah, if you get the chance, and podcast audience, listen to Cheap Wine 3 Day Growth, because he has this, you know, his voice is fucking grizzled because, you know, of all the shit he's done, you know, drinking wise. But his voice would be perfect for AC/DC because it would fit, it fits in with the music so well.
I'm going to have to take your word on that one, man, just because, like, I can't fathom why they went with Axl Rose. It makes no fucking sense to me at all. Like, there are, like you said, there's so many more people you could choose, and you went with the guy whose ego was so massive that he imploded one of the best rock bands of the 80s. Like, you didn't think that might be a bad idea? But then again...
But let's face it, they were probably drunk.
Probably. Plus, Australians are fucking crazy anyway. So, you know, all the shit that AC/DC's been through. If it hasn't killed them yet, Axl Rose probably can't do it.
I swear to God, they need to... create, because they've done it, like, Australia's been having this sort of history. They've done Underbelly, talking about all the gang wars that came up in Australia. They've done Molly Meldrum's life story, which was okay. They've done In Excess's life story, and that was pretty good. Now they need to do fucking.
I can't believe they did fucking In Excess before Akadaka. Like, In Excess before literally one of the most influential bands of all time.
Yeah.
We just know that In Excess isn't more popular than AC/DC. AC/DC has, like, the second highest selling album of all time. You know, their music still gets used all over the fucking place. I know that In Excess is not more popular or more renowned than those guys. But I guess that there is, like, maybe not a method, but it'll all turn right in the end with the way that Australians do things.
Yeah, no, shit just works out for us somehow.
Like, seriously, like, y'all have the fucking craziest history out of just about any fucking country out there. Like, okay, you were a fucking rock in a desert that had aboriginals living on it, and then the British came over and were like, this place sucks, we're gonna put our criminals here. And then the criminals got there and they were like, fuck it, let's turn this into a thriving civilization.
No, and then it got it gets better. Because they're like, you know what, fuck this, their centre's over here, we're gonna take their fucking game and get better at it them. So we took cricket and beat the living shit out of it. So every year, greatest thing, like the rivalry between England and Australia for the Ashes, which I just found out because I didn't know too much about it. And listening, the only way I found out about it was listening to the audio drama of The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy.
Which, if you haven't heard that, go and
look
it up. You
should, because it is hilarious as all fuck. I'm just getting into it. I'm going to pass it on to my dad because he loves that sort of shit. But,
it's fun for the whole family, man.
It is. So people just sit around, gather your hoopty fruits, pour some Pangalactic Gaga Blasters, and listen to this shit. But yeah, I found out that apparently the ashes, the tiny little urn that everyone sees, was the wickets burnt in Melbourne, Australia. Because they're just like, well, fuck it, it's our game now. This isn't cricket, it's cricket.
English cricket is dead. Long live Australian cricket.
If it was really Australian cricket, we'd put animals on the field to chase you the fuck down.
Now you're talking about a game that I would actually go see.
Not ultra cricket. Oh,
I know like jack and shit about cricket, man. I've never watched a game. It always just looks so boring.
It is quite boring, and I'm not into it, but I know basically, because Australians have modified it so we can play it on the beach. And we have these, so we have certain rules. So we have one hand, one bounce. So if the ball bounces once and you catch it in one hand, the batsman is out. There is a rule called tippity, which means that if you hit it, you have to run.
So even if you, like, is there fouls? Is it like any kind of similar to baseball?
Yeah, there's fouls. I mean, in the sense of
like if I know in baseball, if you just tip the ball with your bat and it flies like up and to the right and back past the catcher, then that's a foul and you don't get to run.
We don't have fouls like that. We have one called LBW, leg before wicket. Basically, if you get hit in the leg and they judge it, so if you get hit in the leg, but if your leg wasn't there and it would have hit the wickets, you're out. That's the foul in it.
Jesus Christ.
But yeah, so basically, and then you, like, depending on how hard you hit it. So if you hit it and it flies all the way to the edge of the field without hitting the ground once, that's a six. That's six runs straight up. If it rolls there, then it's like a three or a four, some shit like that. But yeah, like, beach cricket, you can make up your own fucking rules. So it's just like, if the dog cat, you know, that dog's on our team. If he caught it, you're out. But that dog can, that dog just fucking leaps through the air and just catches it. That's fucking cheating. No, he's our best fucking fielder. Then he's going to be useless when That's he goes awesome. Up the bat.
Well, you just have to encourage him. Let him do his thing. He'll learn.
Dog hits a 6. Ah, are you fucking kidding me?
Oh, God. Okay, so, let's do a little bit of, like, backstory for the people who don't know who you are and don't know why I'm having you on my podcast. For those of you who don't know, Crow has been one of my best friends for the past, like, 3 years. I met him, I think I found him on his YouTube channel after he did a collaboration with somebody, and he was in Theatre Obscurum with Doom and Razzle and, what was it, who was it, Delph and Moose.
Delph, Moose, Dimension Bucket, Firefox.
Yeah, Deebles was in there.
Shattered
Storyteller for people who want to look up her YouTube channel. She hasn't done anything in years, but I think she's going to start uploading stuff again.
You need to interview her because she thinks that she shouldn't be interviewed because she hasn't done anything. I'm just like, no, just get on there and just talk. Just like
just talk shit.
Just talk shit.
I mean, eventually, I'm probably going to have most of the Laughably Dapper people on it. Like, I was even thinking about, since I'm planning on doing this, basically until I drop dead from exhaustion, for the 52nd episode, when we've been going with the podcast for a full year, I was thinking of doing a live stream with some Laughably Dapper people.
Oh god, that'd be hilarious. But yeah, so basically,
so yeah, how did you get your start into this whole like creepypasta voice acting YouTube thing?
Well, I was born a poor black child in the heart of Louisiana. I had to make that.
All right, you jerk.
All right, so if I kind of love telling the story. All right, so God, what year was it? 3 years ago. So 2013. Start of 2013, I got some news from a doctor because I had terrible fucking headaches. Turns out that a car accident that I had in 2011 that completely totaled my first car. Had given me basically a blood clot in my brain. Not something that was going to kill me. It was on the very outside of my brain. Like, occipital lobe, which is behind your left ear. And yeah. So, that was the reason I was having headaches and hallucinations. I thought I was schizophrenic for a while. But, so basically they booked me in. It's just like, all right, you need this surgery to get it out. Hopefully something won't go wrong. And so they booked it in for around, at July 2013. And I'm like, okay, if I want to do this, if I want to get through this with something just to show for it, I need to at least say, well, I at least tried narration. Because narration was always something I thought about back in the days where I wrote My Little Pony fan fiction. I wrote it.
Yeah, that's another thing that a lot of people won't know is that Crow is a brony.
He actually went so far as to
write fanfics.
And they were horrible. Like, I won't name names on it, but I wrote some serious bullshit about, let's see, there was a guy who ended up in the lands of Equestria, and the biggest Mary Sue I ever fucking wrote. He gained a daughter, adopted her, small pony child who could change how she looked. Cut off his...
I was about to say, you weren't the guy who wrote that one fucking story. It was like Crystal Fields or something like that was the name of the story. I can't. It's been like 2 years since I've heard of this one. But the guy basically shows up, meets everybody, and then like 4 days into his stay in Equestria, he's like, well, time to fuck a pony.
No. No, that was not me. Like, he was very adamant about not... Because I started out on 4chan.
Oh, God.
Yeah, no, and, like, 4chan's whole thing was... Like, the My Little Pony board was... It started off with...
It was a fucking containment board, is what it was.
Yeah, But it was one of the story threads that started up was this thing called Flutter Rape, which was basically sweet old Fluttershy trying to convince Anon, a human landing in Equestria, that she should, you know, they should have sex.
Oh my god.
And it then evolved into two forms. Fetish Shy, which was she comes around every day checking for a fetish. And some of them got really hilarious. And then there was Apple Rape, which was just like, well, why don't we use someone stronger who would bust your fucking door down, kick your ass, and then take what's hers.
Damn.
And this evolved again into a bigger thing called Anon in Equestria, which was a guy named Anon, or a human named Anon, in the lands of Equestria, dealing with all this shit. And some of the stories were good. Some of the stories were hilarious. One guy that I won't name names, but he wrote an entire series about his character raping every character he could think of.
Jesus fuck. This is why you don't go to 4chan, everybody.
Yeah, but basically, so I got started there and I wrote some... Most of them were crap. And again, the Mary Sue one, so he got captured by Diamond Dogs, cut off his own arm, was given a robotic arm that could use and sense magic, and then found out that how it ended was basically he used white magic, which was life force, to kill Discord. He died, came back to life, because they found out that he wasn't supposed to be dead. And I look back on it and I'm just like, that is the biggest fucking shit heap ever.
It sounds like a real Gary Stu situation.
It really was. And I couldn't see it until I was on the outside.
Take a couple of steps back and then you're like, wow, yeah, man.
There was a hoon, which is basically a guy who... Basically what you see in Fast and the Furious. This guy somehow found his way into the lands of Equestria with his hotted up Subaru WRX. Which is a great car to have. Especially if you go into a land where it's mostly dirt.
Yeah.
Greatest thing to come out of that is the fact that I found out about this ancient cryptid called a dingo neck. D-I-N-G-O-N-E. Yeah, dingo neck. D-I-N-G-O-N-E-K, which is a carnivorous jungle walrus.
You're not...
Yes.
You're not fucking serious right now.
No,
you're
no,
bullshit.
No, I am serious.
You come onto my podcast and try to convince me that they're that carnivorous jungle walruses.
Yes, it's real. I looked it up. And the way I wrote it in the story was basically he does the worm to attack people. Where I went wrong with that story is the fact that humans, because of the high concentration of iron in their blood, were basically immune to magic in most effects. So they couldn't be picked up, they couldn't be shot at, that kind of shit. That went wrong. One of my greatest things that I ever wrote was I basically recreated the Jack the Ripper cases in Equestria.
That sounds pretty interesting.
It was, because I found out, I did a lot of research on Jack the Ripper, and I found out some very interesting things, like the fact that some of his victims were still alive, while some were dead, due to strangulation, because he'd strangle them, and if they were dead, when he cut their throat and they found out he was left-handed, because the cuts went from right to left, if they were already dead, their heart wasn't pumping, the blood would just drain out like blood would. But if their heart was still going, when he cut the neck, it would spurt out like you see in all those goddamn Michael Bay, Quentin Tarantino films. And
hey, don't put Quentin Tarantino and Michael Bay in the same category, man.
Why? They're both shit.
Oh, bullshit! Bullshit! Are we about to start a fight?
I don't know. Should I grab my bottle? Okay, most of Tarantino's films are good. There are some that I don't like Death Proof.
Yeah, Death Proof was okay. It did have Kurt Russell in it.
It did have Kurt Russell. Kurt Russell fixes everything. Django just Unchained, about, just I absolutely about. Loved.
Oh, Django Unchained was awesome. I still need to go finish that one. We got a copy from Redbox a couple of years back, and it was just all fucked up. That's why I don't use Redbox, because you never know what kind of fucking condition. It's a fucking, like, you, do y'all have those in Australia?
We have something like that.
It's a fucking DVD vending machine.
Yeah.
And, like, people think that this is going to be a good idea to put, you know, very delicate pieces of equipment into a vending machine and have people use them over and over and over again like it's going to be fine.
Mm. But it's... So, but I actually learned a lot of interesting stuff, as well as the fact that he removed certain organs.
Really?
And spoiler to the story, people automatically assumed that the human was, you know, the human was the one doing the murders, except that he was locked up when some of the murders went on. Very big spoiler at the end, they thought that it was Dr. Hooves doing the murders. Turns out it was Derpy Hooves.
Really?
Which was, yeah, because she was so tired of every fucker in that town making fun of her, that she literally went out throughout her entire life, studied things to become smarter. No one expected
And then used
anything.
Her knowledge for evil.
Yeah, no one expected anything, because they just thought, because of her wall eyes, she was a fucking moron.
That's a pretty good plot twist right there.
But, and then, so I went out, and I sat down for 6 months, I'm just like, fuck this, I need a new name, I need a new idea, this kind of shit. And so I went out, got a new name under a similar name that I've got now, and wrote about a blind person finding yourself in the land of Equestria, using a lot of references from literature, like The Raven, a lot of Lewis Carroll shit. I loved using Lewis Carroll and his chaotic mind. And basically he just ends up on in Cantlot Castle. And his best friend in the entire world is Discord, who became a gardener after his, turnaround in season 3?
I think that was the beginning of season 2, was when they introduced him.
Well, they introduced him, but it was when he became a better person living with Fluttershy.
Yeah, I think that was the end of season 3.
But yeah.
I think.
He turned himself around, he became, like, in my story, he turned himself around, became a gardener. Still causing a bit of chaos, putting, you know, poison joke and snapping dragons in the garden. But he loved having this guy around because, one, he was blind, he was so much fun to mess with. But he had that hint of chaos that all humans seem to have. And one of the greatest lines that I ever created for it, and I haven't, like, I stopped writing it, and I still want to continue because it had such a great story to it. But he gets sent to Ponyville because the princesses think that he's kind of a shut-in, which he is. He doesn't know the area. He doesn't know what to expect from people. Ponies. And Discord gives him a present before he leaves. And he hears this snapping sound, like a twig snapping, but really thick. And he gives him this thing, and it's one of his horns. And it's just like, if you ever need... And on my boy, if you ever need to contact me, just put this up to your ear. So when he finds himself there, he rummages through his bags and finds this horn, puts it up to his ear, and it just starts ringing. Bring, 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 bring. Hello, bone phone. Discord, put Celestia on the phone right now. Sally, Anon's on the horn for you. That was the greatest line I ever wrote for it.
That's fucking gorgeous.
And, but they're like... Like, honestly, it was so hilarious, so many different points, because him being blind, he used to mess with people. It's just like, he's having a shower, and one of his other friends is a maid in the castle by the name of Feather Duster. And he's in the shower, and he's washing himself, and he's just, oh God, oh God, oh no, what, hang on, what's wrong, what's wrong? I got soot in my eyes, I'm blind! Oh no, oh great! And she stopped, and just like, you're a dick. Nah. He makes, and I learned from my mistakes with creating, Mary Sue, so I made him very not Mary Sue. It took a lot for them to trust him, especially in the ways of the princess. But he gets the trust of Princess Luna, and he makes note of it. It's just like he always addresses her as princess or your highness, because they haven't really made that friendship yet. And so she stops him and just like, Anon, I wish to ask you to, you wish for me to stop hitting you across the head every time you make a stupid comment. No, we wish for you to call us Galaxy Twins and the Two Moon Butts. We wish for you to call it, hey, I just met you, and this is crazy. Here's a Stippins, now call me Luna, maybe. And I thought that was so adorable. But yeah, he just messed with people with his blindness. But yeah, so back to the original point of how I got into this. Off on that fucking tangent that I can still bring myself back from. So yeah, I created a narration of... It was a story I wrote called The Bet, which I have refined, but it was basically this guy finding a message on his computer typed up that says, I wish to make a bet with you, and the typing, the only print would come up if he wasn't in the room. And... greatest twist at the end, not going to spoil it, but yeah, so I created that. I paid one of my artist friends from the Pony Group $50 to draw me some creepy scarecrow art, because that was the name I wanted to go under. And then I went in for surgery, and when I came out, I still had all my memories, so I'm just like, fuck it, this is cool. Alright, join the CPN, make some friends. Oh shit, there's a chat group. And that's where I met Doom. And I met Doom and... God, who else was there? It was like Doom and Carney and...
Yeah, Cat of Carnival, for those who don't know. She also has a YouTube channel, which you can go subscribe to. But I don't think she does much anymore, does she?
She doesn't. She's very off the clock kind of style, but that's Khan's way. I'm happy, but yeah. So it was Doom and Carney and fuck. I think that's all that was from our current group that was there, because we picked up Delph and Moose later on when we were looking for an artist. We picked you up because you were stalking me, you were stalking all of us. DB came in at a later date.
I did that back in the day because I knew that that comments and upvotes and favorites and stuff like that would kind of would boost a video's ranking in YouTube's algorithm. So I would just, whenever I found somebody that I would like, I would watch all of it, because I didn't have a life back then. It was just like, you know, college and the internet was pretty much it. I still don't have a life, but now I'm actually doing something instead of, you know, just laying around the house. But I would find somebody that I would like, that I liked, and I would leave a comment on their video just about every time they uploaded something, to kind of do my part to help boost their rankings, because I usually did that with people that I thought really deserved it or needed help with something, because I have approximate knowledge of many things, and some of it can be a help. So I would, like, you know, okay, maybe you need to, like, you know, kind of do this, kind of just turn this down, or, you know, do a little bit better with your editing or something like that, or give what advice I could. So yeah, I started stalking you guys because I really liked your work, and you had really good YouTube channels, and you guys are kind of part of the reason that I got into narrating.
And honestly, and I'll make this a case in point now, it made my day when I saw comments from you, because it's just like, at least someone likes my work. Because yeah, I'd take it, and, you know, I could show everyone in Theatre Obscurum, and that'd be a great thing, but it's like, I couldn't really... At that time, I was going through a whole lot of shit. I lost my fiance earlier that year, and so I couldn't really trust people around me that I knew were my friends. For some reason, it was just like, my mind's like, well, if you've ever watched Christopher Titus, the inner retard in me is just like, no, they're not making fun. They're not telling you're good. They're making fun of you, okay? Don't believe them. I'm just like, that is a great point. I will listen to you. So when I kept getting these notifications, just like JimFear138 has liked your video, JimFear138 has commented on your video. I'm just like, well, this person I've never met before likes my stuff. Maybe I'm actually doing something right here. And so we actually, when Dimension Bucket brought us into his podcast, we actually got you on for an interview, didn't we?
I believe that did happen at one point. Y'all kind of, I don't know if it was an interview, but y'all kind of brought me in for an episode.
Yeah, and it was just like, we brought you in and then we just never let you go again.
Yeah, basically, that's about how it happened. And the next thing I know, I'm in fucking the Theatre Obscurum chat and I'm helping you guys do videos and I'm getting you guys to help out on my videos, which has been awesome. Like, honestly, I hate doing solo narrations. If I can get somebody to, like, cross-promote and show off, like, how talented my friends are, then I'll do that every fucking time.
And then, of course, when that stayed around for not even a year and a half?
Something like that.
And then shit went down. We had a couple of people who decided to start shit, blaming Doom and I as the people who ran Theatre Obscurum as best we could for the problems that we couldn't, you know, for the fact that we weren't including anyone. Despite the fact that a week before I said, all right, this is how we're going to split up jobs. We're going to get you guys to help find stories. You're going to get you guys to help audio editing. We're going to get you to do go for work so you can go to people because you've got a great attitude. And it just seemed to send shockwaves through everyone, broke everything down. We lost 3 members of the group over it. And
yeah, we
it
lost,
just,
what, wasn't it like, wasn't it Thursday and...
Thursday was lost earlier that year. There was shit that I did, and I apologize. Don't think I've actually apologized to him properly, but I realized that I was the one who was being a dick. I caused all that crap, and he left. And, like, I honestly feel sorry for it. I don't feel sorry for the people we... But, you know, fuck it. Name names. DB left because, well, I don't blame him. You know, because he's still on good terms with us.
Devils is still a friend.
Yeah, and I got no resent for him. Celtic Cabot, she left because she felt she felt afraid of me. I don't blame her. I'm a very aggressive person. The only person I do blame is Morbid Butterfly.
Yeah, I could not wrap my fucking head around that because I had known you for a good, like you said, about a year and a half, and I was like, no, this guy's like the biggest teddy bear in the group. Like, I would say next to Doom, but Doom is a chipmunk, so
yeah. But it's basically how I rationaled it out is the fact that Cabot's got visual impairment, and being visually impaired. And taking this advice from someone who was, you know, I did talk to someone who was blind. And I actually got some information on it. It makes a lot of things a lot scarier, especially audio wise. So when I got angry, she'd get a lot, you know, she'd feel a lot, you know, more uncomfortable around me. So again, I don't blame her. The only one I do blame is Morbid Butterfly, because at that point I was looking for a new house. I was basically on the verge of getting kicked out of my place. I was in trouble. 6 months before that, she had the same problem. She was having trouble with her boyfriend, that kind of shit. And I was working as a baker, and I had fat stacks of cash. So me being the nice guy that I am, I bought them dinner, and I bought them, like, I got pizza delivered to them, a whole bunch of pizza, and it cost me like $50. But I'm just like, fuck it, worth it, they're my friends. And she said, and I'll never let this die, she said to me, if you ever need help, I will be the first one there to help. So when I needed help, she was the first one there to stab me in the back.
Yeah, I'll admit, I was kind of, not drifting away from the group, but I had a lot of shit going on at home and with college at the time. And I was also, this was back when I was modding,
the Rift Cafe Brony Analysis Skype group, because I was one of the only people that nobody had a problem with. And they were like, well, fuck it, everybody likes Jim, we'll just bring him in and have him be a mod. And, you know, that was fun. And it was for a good 6 months there, but then people started being dickholes about the whole thing. Oh, you guys don't do anything. And, well, you guys don't tell us anything. If you came to us with your fucking problem, like, we went and set up a whole fucking... This is why I'll never mod a Skype group ever again. I'm never going to be a community mod for anything ever again. Because we had gone out of our fucking way to message each person individually in the group. And there was, like, a good, I don't know, probably 60, 70 people in this Skype group. We'd gone out of our way to create a specific email, a Gmail account, just so they could email us and let us know what the problems were, and we would take this into the mod chat and work out how to deal with it, and then we would come back to the group with our solutions. Nobody ever... I think one person used it once. And it was just... Like, the whole thing kind of fucking imploded. But, And now it's still going on. I'm not in it anymore, because I'm not really in the brony scene much anymore. I have a few friends that I still talk to from back then, but I'm not really doing the pony thing anymore. But, yeah, so that was going on the whole time. So I was kind of distant from the whole Theatre Obscurum thing. Like, I would come in and I would chill and I would hang with you guys, and then, like, Doom would show up and, okay, we've got this project, we need voice work. Jim, here, take this. And I was like, okay, I'll get you these lines. And I would go and record my shit and then just go back to hanging out. I had no idea that anything was really going down. Until, like, it literally blew up in my fucking face. So that was fun. But, I don't know. I kind of miss the Theatre Obscurum, but it was a really dysfunctional little fucked up family.
It was, and it's like... But it led to better things, because... In the out of the ashes of Theatre Obscurum came Laughably Dapper Entertainment.
I think the thing that really bugs me the most is that Theatre Obscurum is such a good name.
No, it's still a great name, it's just because it's now there. A cola brand.
That's right, oh, it is.
Shit, I just remembered, but did I tell you the idea that Firefox had for a live show ad?
No.
This is an exclusive for all your audience. You're going to love it. Basically, the voice of Obscurum Cola is you, Jim. Voice of Crocodile Energy Drink is me. And we're fighting on stage, fighting over which one's better. And then out walks Fire, the voice of Fox T. And she walks up, and we're not noticing. She walks up to her microphone in between, and then she grabs both our ears. And she drags our heads down to her, and she's like, "What have I told you boys about fighting?" Sorry, sister, we're not fighting, we swear. Yes, we are not fighting, sister. We promise, big sister, we are not fighting. Ah, oh, please stop pulling.
Pain.
And yeah, it's just like Fox T, because if I catch you fighting again, I'll rip it off. And she drags us out the back. Now remember, that came from the mind of Firefox, so you know
it. Oh god, yeah. Fire is awesome. She really does need to get back into doing her YouTube channel, man. Like, she was really good. She's a really, really good voice actor.
She's a wonderful voice actor, and I keep telling you this, but just, you know, she does soft characters so well, because that's what her voice is suited for. But then when you hear her do anything that's got malice in it, like when the first episode of Dichotomy comes out, and you hear the voice of Poisonous Evie, you know you fucked.
Yeah, like, that's one of the things that I've really... like, come to understand about not just the people who were in Theatre Obscurum and are now in Laughably Dapper, but most of the people in Laughably Dapper in general, even a few of the new people. Not gonna lie, there are still some people that need work, but I'm not gonna go naming names or anything like that, because I don't want to make anyone uncomfortable, because we can all afford to get better and do better. But there's just people in Laughably Dapper just have so much fucking range. Like Doom especially. Doom plays like 50% of the fucking characters. And the only way you can tell is because he'll sometimes slip into the wrong accent occasionally. But like Fire, she's brilliant, dude. Like she can do like the really quiet and meek characters, and then she can put on that like sultry, sexy voice, and then she can like get really fucking angry, and like she does a great Scottish accent.
Oh yes, no, that is the scariest. Like her playing Angelina Belmont is the greatest thing ever, because those who know her in real life are just like, no, she's very nice. She will smash down a door to hug you, and then Angelina Belmont comes through. And that's what I love with Doom's writing, is the fact that these characters who seem, you know, two-dimensional in the point that, you know, Angelina Belmont's just a drunk who fights and is fun. But we know, and you know, I'm not going to spoil anything, we know that there is different sides to all the characters that are ever created.
Oh yeah, that's one of the great things about Doom's writing, is that all of the characters are people. They're not one. None of the characters are single note. Even the ones that really do look like it, well, there are a certain couple of characters that are written for specific people that aren't in Laughably Dapper.
Yeah,
and they're just like running gag characters that show up every now and again and be funny and then leave, or they're characters for a specific episode and they're built to fill a specific role. But all of the main characters and the recurring characters have, I guess you could call it hidden depths, to sound like a pretentious twat. But since when have I ever fucking worried about sounding like a pretentious twat?
But it's the fact that, and this has only come up in the last month, that anyone who listens to, you know, goes to listen to the Dichotomy, and I implore you to do so, you'll hear John.
Yeah, I'll link Laughably Dapper's YouTube channel in the description.
So you'll hear how much John and Adelaide love each other. It's obvious. There are that many sweet moments between them. And they will always come up because, well, it's Doom and Russell playing.
But some, and they're just absolutely disgusting with how lovey-dovey they are on a daily fucking basis.
It really is, and despite them being my best friends, one of my best friends, it's like, it really kind of gets on my nerves how much they do that, to the point where I've literally had to say, look, right, I get that you're in love and it's wonderful, but this is my limit. I need you to stop kind of doing this kind of stuff because it's making me uncomfortable.
Oh, no, I love it, man. They're fucking adorable.
They are. That's why I don't say it at first. I give them, you know, I give them this huge leeway, and I don't want to make it sound like they do it a lot. Just that, you know, up to a certain
every point. every now and again, like once every blue moon, they do get a little bit deep with it. But
as
most
I was saying,
of the time, it's just really cute, lovey-dovey shit.
But as I was saying, in the past month, I came up with an idea for my main character that I play. I'm not going to mention which one, but it's basically an idea that I proposed, and it shows this extremely vulnerable, softer side to him that no one could really expect to see coming, and it really gives him this sense of humanity to it, because it's just like he's not just this guy who goes out and solves the problem the way he does. He has this thing always playing on his mind.
Yeah, that's right. You do a little bit of writing for Dapper, don't you?
Yes. I try to. At this point, I'm trying to write an audio drama, and a working title right now for it is called Cattle Lot. It may change in the future, so if you see it come up on a channel and it's under a different name but same basic storyline, that's what I've done.
Which, that'll probably, since it's going to basically be a Laughably Dapper production, it's probably going to go up on Dramatically Dapper. So I'll link Dramatically Dapper down in the description. We are going to be doing stuff with that, guys. It's just everyone's kind of busy right now. We're trying to get Laughably Dapper set up, but we're planning on doing we're going to be doing Crow's Cat a lot. And we have plans to adapt The Lost World by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle into an audio drama. And I'm not talking about the audio drama that the BBC did. That's here on YouTube if you want to look it up. It's okay. They fucked up a couple of things. But we're going to be adapting the whole fucking book. So it's going to kind of be like a narration with, you know, a lot of voice acting and cutting out all of the he said, she said kind of stuff. So that, cause, I mean, the character, you're going to know who the characters are because they're all going to be individually voiced.
Yeah.
But, yeah, sub to Laughably Dapper and Dramatically Dapper, guys, because stuff is going to be happening on those channels.
Yeah. So, like, and at this point, I've only written 2 episodes of it, and with the way I write, I'm going to make sure I've written every episode down and cast everything before we even start recording. But another side project that I'm doing that I've got to finish writing of is less dramatical, but it's a very old project that I created back when Theatre Obscurum was still a thing, where basically Arcane Razzle is transported into old literature. And the first book she ends up in is Alice in Wonderland, where all the characters are represented by her friends. And the greatest thing to come out of that is the fact that both Jim and I play, respectively, the Mad Hatter and the March Hare.
No, I thought you were the Hatter and I was the Hare.
Oh, yeah, sorry. I'm playing the Wandering Hatter, and Jim Fear, anyone who's actually seen him, plays the Much Hare. And the way that they get introduced in the book is the fact that they're talking at the exact same time with this dumbfounded look. And I swear to God, if I can convince Moose to do the drawings of this, even if it's just like the original sketch drawings that Lewis Carroll put into his book, of just the Much Hare and the Wandering Hatter staring at them while talking in unison about a swan that one of them stole from the Royal Gardens.
I do remember going through like the first script or two of that back when Theatre Obscurum was still a thing, and I really did enjoy that story. I hope you do continue it, because that would be a lot of fun to produce.
And then I've been trying to figure out where to take, which other books to take it through, and another one that comes to mind is Moby Dick, where... And
I was just thinking Moby Dick. Moby Dick would be a lot of fun.
Moby Dick, and it's just like, so I played Captain Ahab, Jim's Ishmael, and the whale, and I only do this because of the idea that I came up with, but the whale played by Shattered Storyteller. And basically when the whale's, you know, whale's sighted, Ishmael's like, the whale is off the port bow! And Captain Crowhab jumps onto the whale, and then just starts hugging. It's just like, no, no, you don't care. Don't listen to them. You're not fat. No, you're not fat. You're a whale. You're the perfect size for a whale. You don't have to worry. And then the third idea is not even classic literature. It's just literally Arcane Razzle finds herself in the cloudy, misty town of Forks. No, fuck this. Fuck this shit. I'm not doing this. I am not being put into this bullshit vampire pseudoism story. You can take your dick-sucking vampires and shove it up their sparkly asses. I'm out of here. And that was Twilight.
One episode, 2 minutes long.
2 minutes long of just... of just Razzle ranting on about...
how bad fucking Twilight sucks.
Yes, because I will get my revenge.
Like, have you ever tried to read Twilight?
I read that one where it's from the perspective of Edward, and it was horrible.
I tried to read the first one. Yep. Like, I have a friend. He's like a year older than me, male, like straight as straight can be. Like, it just straight as a fucking arrow. And he loves Twilight. But he started reading this series and just fell in fucking love with it. And I have no idea why. And he lent me the first book. And he was like, no, just try it. Just try it and you might like it, you might not, but whatever. So I started reading it. I got like 4 chapters in and my fucking brain tried to crawl out of my ears with how bad the goddamn writing was. It was so fucking god-awful. And everything was so bland and uninspired.
Yeah.
And, like, the grammatical errors and everything like that. Like, I'm sorry, guys, but if there's a story out there, like, I will take requests on stories that I want to read, that I'll narrate and stuff like that, and eventually I'll set up a proper way to submit those instead of just saying that I'll do it. But, if there's, like, serious heavy grammatical errors, that shit's gonna have to be fixed, man. Because I'm not gonna spend an hour stumbling through your 5-page story trying to get the reading right when I don't know what you're saying because there's so much bad wording and phraseology and horrible, horrible punctuation and run-on sentences and everything like that. It's just, like, clean it up.
Mm-hmm.
Clean it up, guys. I can't count how many stories that I've been, like, on the Creepypasta wiki or creepypasta.com. Or I've even started going through Reddit's R No Sleep. I can't count how many stories I've discounted because I'll get, like, 2 paragraphs in and it'll be just, like, the worst writing from, like, a structural standpoint. From, like, looking at this as a narrator, like, I have to read this. I have to be able to read this out loud and put the proper inflections into it. And there's nothing in this that gives me any kind of indications to how this character should sound. Nope, fuck it, gone, next.
Mm. I should pass you on the story, one story that I read, and it was really good. It was about doppelgangers and shit like that. I think it was called The Porch Light Was Left On. But yeah, I'll pass.
That sounds cool.
It was really good, and the only sad thing about it is the guy only wrote 2 stories of it. And I really want to find out in the end what the fuck was going on. But, yeah, no, the guy who passed on, the guy I got the, Midnight Sun, whatever that fucking Twilight book was called, from, was this 30-something-year-old radiographer from the X-ray company I used to do office work for. And this guy was...
That's not creepy at all.
No, this guy was, actually, he was fairly, I don't even think he was in his 30s, he was young as hell. He drove a brand new, what you'd call, what's the word? Chevy. But in Australia, they're called Holden Commodores. Brand new one, V8. Fucking, the sound system in this was fucking beautiful. He actually got me into Charlie the Unicorn as well. So I don't hate him for everything. But yeah, he was big on Twilight, and I'm just like, I'll read it. And it was really horrible. But what can you expect from fan fiction?
I can only imagine. Yeah, what was it fan fiction of?
Basically, it was Stephanie Meyer's fucking fantasy about being fucked by a 104-year-old virgin. And the greatest thing that came out of it is the fact that the only people who hate Twilight more than the people who have read it and noticed all the shit sentences like JimFear are the people who had to be in the movie, like Robert Pattinson.
Yeah, God, like he cannot fucking stand Twilight. Like, apparently they had like a wire in his collar to make it look disheveled. And he was talking about how that was the most pretentious thing he'd ever seen in his life was somebody who was deliberately, you know, mussed and ruffled like that. There's so much fucking wrong with Twilight. So much wrong with it. Not the least of which is 50 Shades of Grey.
Yeah, because 50 Shades of Grey is a goddamn fanfic of Twilight.
The thing that really pisses me off about Fifty Shades of Grey, though, is that once the movie came out, everybody and their fucking feminist lapdog was talking about how, oh my god, this is patriarchal oppression of women, and it's so horrible that this fucking movie is coming out, and this woman is being mistreated in it, and there's a rape scene in this shit, and, like, I'm sitting here like, okay, who wrote it, and who's the primary consumer?
Women.
A woman wrote it, and women are the primary consumers. They love it. They absolutely love it. Women turn those books into international bestsellers. Some of the most well-selling books of all time are the 50 Shades of Grey series. And that's really, really sad, A. And B, if these women are enjoying it this much, how are men fucking them over when men had almost nothing to do with it?
So,
like, I really do not get that leap in logic.
I guarantee you, the women who are complaining about it being patriarchal bullshit and men raping women, all that kind of crap, are the same women who go home at night, read it, and then just mess up their fucking bed.
They're just flicking their beans all night to it.
They've got the Turbo Master on a fucking saber saw going, you know, in ogre drive with the green ass, the limited edition Shrek dildo that's bigger than fucking Hulk Hogan's arm going to fucking town on him. But then they need a diesel generator to keep that shit run.
Oh, God. Like, that to me shows how ridiculous. Like, we don't have to talk about this shit if you don't want to, but this is one of my favorite subjects. It just shows me how ridiculous feminism has become at this point in time.
Hmm.
Like, the fact that these people, these mostly women and occasionally their stiletto-licking lapdogs, will look at something that was made by women for women. It was consumed by women primarily. I actually did the numbers on this. I actually looked up the numbers on this once. Apparently, like, 20%, maybe, of the people who bought 50 Shades of Grey were men. And most of those men, when interviewed, said that they did it just to see what the fucking fuss was. Like, they weren't actually interested in it. They were just like, well, if this is really popular, I should probably see what's going on. Or maybe they were forced to read it by their wife or their girlfriend or something like that. But, yeah, like 70 to 80% women bought this and made it an international bestseller. And it does have some really bad shit in it. I'm not even going to sit here and try and defend 50 Shades of Grey. But they look at that situation and they say, this is men's fault. Because men.
And the greatest thing I've ever read about it is the fact that someone goes, it's not men's fault for this shit, because the whole story is unrealistic. The only reason that he got away with what he did is because he's a fucking billionaire. If he was in a trailer, it would be a fucking Criminal Minds episode.
You're not wrong. You're not wrong.
But on the fact of feminism, I get, because I have a Tumblr, I get that much fucking hate mail. One of the more recent ones is the fact that I've been apparently sending sexual messages to someone I've never met, who I don't even know because they refuse to disclose the name, but I should be ashamed, and if I don't stop, they'll go to everyone in Laughably Dapper and start messaging them about how I am cheating on Carney, blah, 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 fucking blah. But one of the stupidest things I ever got was, you should apologize to black people for the slave trade because you're white. And I'm like,
wait, hold on.
Excuse me? Like, if anything, me and black people have got a lot in common. We both got chucked on a fucking ship and sent off to a new fucking country against our will. The English should apologize to us for the prisoner trade.
Yeah, I mean, you turned an entire fucking continent into a penal colony. The bastards. Like, I don't know how bad the crime problem was in Britain at the time, but if you have to take a whole continent and just, we're gonna put all our criminals here because there's no more room for them in Britain.
We're gonna take this, alright, lads, this is what we're gonna do. Alright, we're gonna take all our criminals, we're gonna put them on this really dangerous rock. But yeah, doesn't this seem like a stupid idea? Nah, the animals will kill them. We'll check back in on them in like 5 years, they'll be dead. 5 years later. Alright, let's go check on them. Fuck, they've survived. Fuck, they've tamed the beast. Fuck, we're fucked. Oh god, funny thing ever.
And the Australians proved that when they came for the English's ass in cricket.
Hmm. And funniest thing ever I actually heard about the Australian accent is the fact that the Australian accent is literally just the Cockney accent. Slowed down because of the fucking heat. Just like, it's like, alright, I'm going to get on the fucking plane. I don't want to get off the fucking plane. Oh, Jesus Christ, it's fucking hot. Why?
Oh, God, a bunch of Cockney people got shipped down to fucking Australia and started bitching because of the heat, and then you have the accent. That's one of the things that I really do, like, I don't have a lot of evidence for this, because I haven't put in the time researching it, but I have this little pet hypothesis, that the reason that, like, Australians are mostly chill, like, I've met a few Australians, and I've never met any Australian that was, like, a serious douche. I know they exist. But I haven't met many of them. I haven't heard of many Australians that are assholes. Most Australians are pretty chill, I think. People in, like, Brazil, the South in America, everyone's kind of really, really chilled out. Like, the best example in America is Charleston, South Carolina, when that cop shot that guy. Like, last year, I want to say, like, the guy was running away, and the cop fucking unloaded into this dude's back. Just laid him out, man. Like, that guy is gone, not getting up. And the Black Lives Matter people came to South Carolina, and, like, Al Sharpton came to South Carolina and shit like that. And they were like, this is horrible, the white people are oppressing you, and you know, you need to strike back against police violence and shit like that. And then everybody in South Carolina was like, no, the cop lost his job. He's going to prison for murder. Go away.
What the fuck you going on, brother?
No riots. No riots in Charleston, South Carolina. Meanwhile, Baltimore.
Oh.
And I'm looking at all of these people up north. And they're, oh no, the South is horribly racist, and there's just a bunch of cousin fucking rednecks who hate niggers and wear their Klan hoods all over the place and shit like that. And I'm living here, and I'm like, do you guys not see what happened in your city because of race, like, not a year ago? Like, Washington, D.C., you know, Denver, well, Detroit, that's what I was thinking of, like, Detroit, Philadelphia... They have way bigger problems with race up there than we do down here. We've kind of, like, gotten over it. For the most part. There's not a whole lot of, like, actively racist people down here that, like, sit around just, like, drinking Budweiser. Like, boy, I sure would, like, kill me a nigger. They don't really exist down here. Like, that's a really, really bad, inaccurate stereotype of Southern people.
Because they all went north.
Yeah, they all went north and started causing problems. But I have this theory that if you put a group of people in a really hot environment for generations upon generations, eventually they will become so chilled out that they will be a completely separate people from everybody else. Like, the Southern accent sounds like nothing else that you hear in America. Like, I'm dead certain that Brazilian Portuguese sounds nothing like Portuguese Portuguese.
Yeah.
And then there's Australian English and English English. So I just have this theory that, like, hot environments
chill people out because it's too fucking hot to get mad about stupid
no,
shit.
No, 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 that's absolutely true. It's just like, oh, fucking, it's too fucking hot to do anything. That being said, one of the greatest things that ever came out of Australian history that I can remember is the Cronulla race riots, where basically all the Lebanese people and all the white Australians went down to Cronulla Beach and had a fucking fist fight.
Really? Yeah.
And that was fucking amazing, because it's just like, Jesus Christ, that took some organization. That really took some fucking organization. I'm proud. I'm not even angry. you've made me proud. But you look at Australian history, and it's just like, well, fuck, the only way to explain it is because they're fucking Australian. Like, we lost a prime minister in the ocean named Harold Holt. He walked in the ocean and never returned. So what's the best thing we can do?
Some people say he's still out there and will return one day.
When Australia really needs him the most. Well, what do? Name a fucking swimming pool after him. Like, everything about Australia is is so shittily fucked up that it's just like...
No, you guys have the best sense of humor, I swear
it's
to God.
No, but that's the best thing about it, because it's so shittily fucked up. The only way you can explain it is it's Australian. Like, the most venomous snake, land snake, on the world is the inland taipan found in Australia. Can kill 183 grown men with a single dose of venom, which is akin to using an atom bomb to go deer hunting. Because it only eats small mammals. It is also the most timid snake in all the fucking world and will hide like a motherfucker. So if you go, as long as you don't go stomping around and starting shit, it will not attack you. Like, and the greatest thing of all is it's bitten so many people, none of which have died. It is yet to kill a single human being. That's fucked up.
Oh, God. That is fucked up. Meanwhile, we just have, like, rattlesnakes around here, which people are constantly fucking with for no good reason.
Yeah. Well, fun fact about Australian snakes as well. Because the reason that Australian snakes are so venomous is because they can't inject like a rattlesnake can. They can't inject their venom. It has to go down grooves in the back of their fangs. So, it just lets it drip down, which is why it's so venomous. Also, the fact that the venom doesn't go through the bloodstream, it goes through the lymph node system. One guy got bitten by a fucking king brown snake, you know, number 5 in the world. He literally sat down in the middle of the bush, called up the emergency services, told them where they were, and sat there for 3 days straight and survived. Just like, nah, fuck this, not moving.
Actually, that's pretty smart.
It is, because if you don't move, you don't die.
Yeah, you don't circulate it around as fast.
Australia has the world's biggest crocodile, the saltwater crocodile, 7-8 meters in length.
God,
we also keep one in a zoo, and we gave it a name, named Eric, and he is a national fucking icon, like the crocodile hunter, and that's just.
That's cooler than some of our national icons.
The fact that the crocodile hunter picked up snakes and spiders and crocodiles and then got, you know, and it was so sad when people found out the reason he died, not just because of the stingray, was because he was filming stuff for his daughter's TV show.
Oh,
damn. Like, he was out doing shit for his TV show, but, you know, he thought, oh, you know, she'd love some footage of stingrays for her show, and it would take such a psychological toll to know that shit.
Yeah, just holy shit. Like, I don't know, man. Steve Irwin was just the bomb. Like, my favorite thing that I saw him in, he did a commercial for, like, I can't remember what the fucking commercial was for. It was for, like, emergency service or something like that, or God, I cannot remember what it was for, but he was standing out in the. It looked like he was out in the Australian bush, and he was holding this snake. He's like, "Oh no, she's a beauty," and then the snake bites him. And like, this is the guy that'll sit there and like let a snake gnaw on his fucking arm.
Yeah.
Just like, no, this doesn't hurt. This is fine.
It'll let go when it gets tired, kind of shit.
That was on a TV show as well. It was like he had a python, very small python, probably like a children's python in his hands, and it just bit his neck. It's just like, no, it's all good. It hurts. No, I'm good.
No, it's fine. Just like sitting there with a snake dangling from his neck, like it's a fucking earring.
You know.
But he was like, you know, he got bit by the snake, and he was talking about how, oh, this is one of the most venomous snakes in the entire world. And then it just bites him, and he's like, oh, shit, I'm bitten. And don't worry. But then he looks up, and he sees the camera, and he's like, yeah, don't worry, everybody. We have the anti-venom. Everything's going to be fine. And then he looks over to his aide, and his aide kind of gives him the no signal. He's like, I'm being told that we don't have the anti-venom, but don't worry. Everything's going to be good. They're going to get me on a helicopter. And then he just hits the dirt. Like, it wasn't even one of those things where they had, like, a mat underneath him. He just, like, hit the fucking ground.
Jesus Christ. And
Steve Irwin was the man.
He was, and it's the fact that he did that much... He did that much fucking shit that, like, even though he's gone, he's still Australia's national icon. It's just, like, because that's the kind of guy you want to be in this world.
Oh, yeah. Well, minus all of the fucking with dangerous animals.
No, fuck, let's go out and do that shit.
This is the biggest crocodile in the entire world. I'm gonna sneak up on it and stick my finger in its butthole.
I'm a
genius idea. Stick. Genius fucking plan.
Genius fucking plan, mate. Oh, shit. What else is fun about Australia? The fact that in 5 years, we've had 5 separate prime ministers. That's hilarious.
Yeah. I had Cloud Cuckoo Country on. He was talking about that. He kind of broke that. That's one of the funniest fucking things in politics that I've ever heard of. Like, y'all just keep kicking them out. I wish we could do that with our politicians.
Well, we did that with the entire parliament. It was just like they couldn't come up with a decision, so they fired the entire parliament, shut down for a day, and came back with a new parliament. And it never happened again. Because they learnt their fucking lesson.
That's the best way to do politics. I mean, I've said for the longest fucking time, not necessarily on this podcast, but just, like, in conversations with people, that one of the biggest problems in America is career politicians. So you don't have people getting up there to actually benefit people and be statespersons. You get people up there who are trying to make, like, fat bank and push their agenda. So, like, we have all of these career politicians. I think that a lot of America's problems could just be solved by just getting rid of everybody in the Senate.
Yeah.
And the House, too. Like, just clean fucking House, kick them all out, elect new people. But we kind of do that every couple of years, because I think the Senate is elected every 4 years with the president, and the House is every 2 years. But... I don't know. It just, like, the whole political process in America is just fucked. As you can see, if anybody has been paying attention for the past year or so. It seriously bothers me that Donald Trump is a viable candidate for president.
That bothers me, too, because it's just, like, it's going to turn America not into a country, but into a business.
Yeah, because it worked out so great with Herbert Hoover, didn't it? But did you hear about the whole Hillary Clinton hot sauce thing?
No, what happened?
Oh my god, she was on... I can't remember what the name of the show is. I'll look it up right quick and shoot you the link. And I can probably edit this into the podcast, because we're recording this on Tuesday, so I've got time to actually go in and edit it before it goes up on Saturday. But yeah, let me just... Hillary Clinton hot sauce. That should get us a hit on YouTube. Okay.
No, yeah, this isn't a good one, because she did it so fucking fast. It was ridiculous. This looks like it. Apparently the show, it's like a black political show on TMZ, apparently. But it wasn't even a half a second, dude. Like, look at this here. I'll send you the link. I'll put it in the podcast so that everybody knows what we're talking about. But just watch like the first couple of seconds of this and see how fast she responded.
Come on, Australian internet.
Yeah, that's why we don't let you host calls.
That the fact that if I'm allowed to have any sort of power, I abuse it.
Immediately. You've kicked me from groups so many fucking times.
No. The only one I've actually kicked from... Actually, the only person I've kicked more than anyone else is Delph. Because he's such... Do not want to hear his fucking puns ever again.
Delph is the pun lord, man. He's like High Lord Master of puns. He's put effort into mastering that art form. But yeah, just like, if that isn't the biggest... canned response I've ever seen. Like, she didn't even give it a second.
Yeah.
It was just hot sauce. Boom. It's like, okay, so, you're trying to lose the black vote, are you? Didn't even wait. And then the look on that girl's face on the right after she says that, she's just confused. No idea how to react to that. Oh, God. And the thing that really bothers me about this is, like, they didn't ask her to bust out the hot sauce. Like, if you watch Steven Crowder's show, he brought this up. They were, like, you know, if you like hot sauce, then, you know, you have preferences. There's, like, you know, your sriracha sauce, your ghost pepper sauce, your, you know, what's the other one? Dave's Insanity Sauce, stuff like that. You know, you have your preferences. If you're a hot sauce enthusiast, if you carry hot sauce around with you all the time, you should have it on you right now. So let's see the fucking hot sauce, Hillary. Show us the hot sauce. This is what Black Lives Matter should be attacking right now. They should be showing up outside of Hillary Clinton rallies with signs that say, show us the hot sauce.
Give us the hot sauce, bitch.
Sauce, please. Oh, God. So, do you have any preferences in the American presidential race? Just ask somebody who's completely outside of the process.
Oh, God. What's that guy? Thurman. Free ponies for everyone.
Vermin yes. Supreme?
Free ponies for everyone.
I do like Vermin Supreme. He's got a good platform. I wonder if he's just, like, by himself, or is he actually running as, like, under a third party? Because there are third parties in America. There's, like, the Green Party and a couple of others. I wonder if he's actually with one of those people, or if he's just kind of there. It's a little bit sad that that guy doesn't get more attention, because he would have made, like, the Republican primaries infinitely more funny. You got Ben Carson falling asleep over there. You've got Donald Trump attacking everyone in sight. Marco Rubio talking about how small Trump's penis is. And then Vermin Supreme over there with the giant fucking rubber boot on his head.
And then you got motherfucking Ted Cruz, the Zodiac Killer, ready to get out there and just start causing shit.
I actually think that might be true.
Hey, I'm not one to deny the fact that Ted Cruz looks like someone who would fucking kill people.
He really does have that, like, skeezy used car salesman vibe, doesn't he? Like, he just looks like somebody who's probably, like, got fangs. Like, snake fangs, not, like, cool vampire fangs or anything like that. Like, he's got snake fangs somewhere.
Like, he just looks like the kind of guy who's just sitting there, you know, that smile on his face, and it's just like, I could be out killing people right now, but I need to apply to be president. Why is my fan?
Oh, God, I hate that I'm voting for that guy. I really do. I really do fucking hate it. But everybody else is just so abominably bad. And he's the only one that I've seen actually stick to the issues instead of, like... Like, the only instance of mudslinging I've seen Ted Cruz do was when he was on a talk show or something. And the host was like, you know, so if you're backing your car up and you see Donald Trump walking behind you, do you stop? And then he was like, well, you know, Donald, I respect Donald and everything, but I can't say at this time which pedal I would hit. I was like, okay, yeah, all right, funny joke, but, you know, if you're trying to take the moral high ground, that's a little, anyway, let's get off this shit, because this is fucking boring, and I do this shit every week, because I listen to this shit way too fucking much anyway.
Oh, jeez.
So what are you drinking right now? Are you drinking some of the good beer that Australians keep for themselves while shipping out the Fosters Americans just like me?
What fucking American sends out is what Budweiser, all that shit. Coors.
Now, Budweiser is something, as shocking as it sounds, Budweiser and Coors are things that people in America legitimately think are good. Like, a lot of people. That is not, like, Americans don't look at Budweiser like, okay, this is the piss water that we're going to ship overseas and pretend that this is American beer. No, that's American beer. Pabst Blue Ribbon. Oh, God, no. Fuck Pabst. Pabst is the worst beer on the market. It really is. It sucks. Nah, Pabst is that fucking hipster shit. Like, every time you go to a fucking college party with a bunch of poor people, or like, one of those, like, hippie liberal collectives that all live in one house and shit like that because they're too poor to get anything for themselves, and they don't want to work, everything, it's just like, the fridge is always stocked with Pabst Blue Ribbon. I do not understand why. Like, if you guys can afford a house, you can probably set aside some good beer money.
It's, the way I see it is the fact that, and this is just shit I've seen with Australians when I started growing up drinking. When you first start drinking, you'll drink anything you can get your hands on. And the biggest one for Australians to drink is Victorian Bitter, which is made by the same company that makes Foster's, that kind of shit. And it's okay. But it takes a while for people to realize that you don't need to drink cheap beer and cheap, getting Jim Beam, that kind of crap. You can actually buy spirits and make proper drinks. And you can spend a bit of money. Like, what I drink, I drink a lot of craft beer because it's, you know, you get a better... It's fucking delicious.
It's fucking delicious.
The reason I got into it is because my mum can't drink... She can't, I think she's allergic to phosphates now, or phosphorus or some shit like that, so she can't drink ciders or wines, because without this additive to add in to get rid of it, but she can drink craft beer. So I'm just like, I want to find a craft beer that my mum would like, and I found some, and then I found this stuff called Ruby Tuesday, which is made by a company in Australia called Matilda Bay. They make a really good amount of beer. There's a honey wheat beer called Bee's Knees. There's I got pale ales called Lazy Yak and Fat Yak and all that kind of shit. And Ruby Tuesday is an amber ale, which is a very, like, almost reddish brown beer, and it's delicious because it's got a, you know, nice malty flavor without that bitterness.
That does sound good. I'm gonna have to, like, get, like, I'm gonna have to start another fucking bank account just to order beer from around
the world. That's what I'm, like, when I come to America at some point, I will pack my, like, I'll pack two suitcases. One's filled with clothes, one's filled with just, like, a couple of kinds of beer.
Oh, like, that would be awesome.
Just, like, open it up and just, like, enjoy.
Because I'll try drinking damn near anything. Like, the only thing that I won't try is proper real absinthe. Because it has psychoactive elements in it.
Which is funny enough, because Wormwood's all around Australia. It's just called by a different name. I learned. Oh.
That's interesting.
So, the back...
It's also fucking poisonous. Not that alcohol in general
greatest alcohol story I've got is back when I first became a chef, I worked for this guy and he was the most awesome chef I've ever met. Like, he couldn't sleep at night, so he'd work at different restaurants around the city. So during the day he'd work at the cafe teaching me, and it was just me and him, and then at night he'd go work for another place. He didn't even need to open the paycheck he got from the cafe. He just worked and, you know, didn't touch a dime of it because he made so much money off having a farm and working at other restaurants. He's Australia's number one dom, male dom. Serious.
Are you serious?
Like, he showed me catalogs of shit and I'm just like, okay, I didn't need to know about that kind of chastity belt, but thank you. He has a cattle prod which he brought into work and threatened to use on me if I didn't work hard. I said that if he did that, I'd break it over his head and then show him what real cattle prodding is. But he took me out to dinner. He took me out to dinner twice just because he wants to show me. At that point, he wanted to show me, you know, real proper restaurants.
But he was trying to get a new pants.
Not like, awesome guy. I went to his apartment, which doesn't make it sound any better. But went to his apartment, and his lounge room wall, just one wall filled with spirits, and spirits I've never even heard of. And he pulled down this black bottle, poured out three shots for me, him, and his housemate. Black absinthe. And so I took the shot, the 18-year-old that I was, and it burnt. I mean, it hurt like fucking hell. And he's like, you want another one? I'm like, ugh! And he pulls it, and he's just like, go ahead. And I took the shot, and I couldn't feel a thing. My throat was dead to the world. And that's how he prepared me for his 14-inch cock. I love it
when that shit happens.
But no, so, like, we went out,
lucky restaurant,
because in Melbourne, Australia, and if you ever get to come to Melbourne, I swear to God, I'll take you to Lygon Street. Lygon Street is where multicultural food comes alive, because it's high quality, and every restaurant has a different culture to it. So we went to a place called Copperwood, which is an Italian restaurant, and this place was immaculate. Very small dining area, kind of shit like that. But because he'd done work there, we got a table. We got greeted and sat within 15 seconds, despite the restaurant being busy, because they had three different hostesses? Maitre d's. There was slight problem with one of the meals. It came out a little bit cold. We were given a $750 bottle of wine to apologize for it. Yes. Because they pride themselves on doing everything to the utmost level. This is like fine dining in close quarters. Like, there was, I worked with a guy who actually did fine dining at, a place called D'Estasio's. And he tried to turn the restaurant I was working at into a fine dining restaurant and it didn't work out. And he's like, oh, you'll never do fine dining. I'm just like, yeah, well, yeah, probably not. And he's like, where have you actually gone to eat? And I'm like, oh, here, there, everywhere. Went to a place called Copperwood. And he looked at me and he's like, you went to Copperwood? I'm like, yeah. How did you afford it? I went there with my last chef. And he's like, how did you get a reservation? He worked there. Like, this place is high class kind of shit, but... The second place he took me back when I was shit. Like, I wasn't even his apprentice anymore. I was fired because the boss wasn't planning to keep me around. But he took me there for my birthday, and we went to the casino in the city, and a new restaurant had opened up, and it was called Maze. And if the name doesn't tip you off, the guy who comes out next.
Yeah, so I'm kind of getting.
We sit down,
idea.
We have a meal, and I feel a tap on my shoulder. And I turn around, and there's Gordon Ramsay. Yes.
No.
No, it's Gordon
You're
Ramsay, and I'm looking at him.
Gordon Ramsay. You're lying,
no,
you motherfucker. You
hand
you
to God. Hand to...
You come onto my podcast, and you,
hand to fucking
you spread God. Lies like this. Next you're going to be telling me that you were there
well, I
when
mean,
Steve
the,
Irwin
the
died.
Stingray, not... But I'm hand to God. I turn around, there's Gordon Ramsay, and I'm immediately stunned. And he's like, well, how is the meal? And I got to say, like, Gordon Ramsay, don't believe, like, everyone, you know, you see him on TV, he's not a dick. He only does that because, well, some people need to get their ass kicked. You want a real idea of what Gordon Ramsay's like? MasterChef Kids
True.
Is how he really is most of the time because he's honestly caring. So he's like, how's the meal? And I don't know what to say. So I look at him just like, excuse me, I'm trying to have a meal here. Why the hell are you interrupting me? And I turn back around, go to take another bite, and then I turn around again. It's like, I'm so sorry. I just had to say that. Please don't get angry at me. Please don't leave. And he's like, he was honestly the nicest guy I've ever met. I mean, I've met asshole chefs, and he was far from it. It's like meeting your hero. It's like meeting Bill Murray,
that's
but
incredible.
In chef form.
That does sound really cool. Like, from all accounts, Bill
yeah.
Murray is, like, the nicest guy you could ever
hope
to meet.
He'll steal your chips and no one will ever believe you.
Yep. Yep. He will. But yeah, it's like you were saying, like people, these young kids that just get into drinking, they're just drinking whatever they can get. Mostly, I think, in America, this is how we did it anyway, was we were drinking, like, shit, like malt liquor, because it was the only thing that we could get a hold of, because there was a store way out in the country. Like, you had to ride for 45 minutes to find this place. Luckily, one of my friends lived, like, 10 minutes away from this place. So we would all hang out at his house because it was outside of city limits. We didn't have to worry about the cops. And we could just sit in his shed and listen to music and talk shit and get drunk. So we would go out to this place and we would just pick up a bunch of, like, Bud Light and malt liquor and just get drunk because we were underage and he was the only guy who would sell to us. Because he didn't give a fuck. Like, this place also had wrap snacks, which I've never seen anywhere else before ever in my entire life. I haven't tried looking them up on the internet, but I doubt they're going to be up there. But it was basically wrap themed chips, like potato chips that had like wrappers on the package and shit. Like, they had like Lil Jon and Snoop Dogg and shit like that on the package. I had no idea where the fuck he got that shit from, but I mean, now that I'm, like, I've grown and I've got past that whole I need to drink to kill the pain kind of thing, like, I'm sitting here drinking Rumplemints. Like, you can actually, it actually does pay off to spend a little bit more money to drink better beer
like
and
liquor. I bought this slab of Ruby Tuesday from my local liquor store for, shit, what was it, $56 for a slab? Of 24. So, coming out at just over $2 a bottle. which is pretty good because each individual bottle sells for about $4.50. No.
In bars? Oh my god! You're paying $4.50
yes.
in Australian for a yeah. bottle of this beer? That's like $48 for a fucking 24-pack, dude. This better be the best beer anybody's ever tasted.
Like, a six-pack of it costs 22. But yeah, it's nice. No, I'm willing to splurge out this money, especially for a slab because it's so cheap. For this shit, because it's nice flavor. Alcohol percentage is...
What's the alcohol percentage?
4.5.
God damn, that's like
yeah.
Budweiser, dude. That's crazy. Like, this bottle of Rumplemints that I have here, it's... Let's see. Is this a 150? A 750? Let me see here. It should have the volume on it some fucking where. 1 liter. Thanks. This is the only fucking that's alcohol like that comes in liters. Yeah. It's... But it's also 100 proof. So you don't need a whole lot of it to just get absolutely blazed.
Shit, that is a lot of alcohol. Because 100 proof is like... 50% alcohol.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly 50%. But Rumplemints is really good shit. Like, it's very, it's schnapps. So it's nice, it's got a nice peppermint flavor. Also, I kind of associate peppermint schnapps with my dad. Because he got really into drinking schnapps. And... Every time he comes down for the weekend, he brings a bottle home with him. And we'll sit there and watch. Like, last time he came down, we watched, like, Mad Max Fury Road. And just sat there and, like, drank schnapps all night and watched Mad Max. And it was a lot of fucking fun. So, I'm just getting the feeling that, like, one of these days, like... When my dad passes on, like, this is one of the things that I'm going to remember and associate with him. Also, it's high-class liquor, and it's really good shit. So, like, spending like, $35 on a liter of Rumplemints isn't really that big of a deal. Like, I used to spend, like, $15 on a gallon and a half of Old Crow just so I would have something to get. It's kind of like how I do, like, you know how I do the boxed wine now? Where I'll just pick up 5 liters of wine for, like, $22 because it's cheap and I can drink it throughout the week. I would do that same thing with whiskey. I would just get this giant jug of whiskey for, like, of crap whiskey. It's absolute shit. Anybody who's listening out there, do not drink Old Crow unless you want to have a bad time or you're an experienced alcoholic. But I would just buy this giant jug of whiskey and just have it sat in my room and just drink off it whenever I fucking felt like it. Because I'm a bad person. Don't drink, kids. Don't get into the life. That's another thing, is that a lot of people can't fucking handle it. Like, a lot of people just can't handle drinking. Like, and this is... And this is coming from, like, a functional alcoholic. So, you know, I understand the fact that I'm addicted, but at the same time, I still get up at 6:30 every morning and go to fucking work, you know?
Yeah. And that's what I'm going to, like, that's... Again, going back to Titus. That's what I'm going to say at my dad's funeral. My dad drank a lot. My dad smoked a lot. He smoked things that he should not be smoking. He found an addiction to pain pills because he had constant headaches. He also never missed a day of work, even when he had pneumonia. He made sure that there was food in front of me and my sister, even if he meant he didn't eat for that night. And he taught me how to be a real fucking man. Not going out and fighting and being tough and all that shit, but to take responsibility for the shit you've done. Because he never copped out at anything he did.
Is that Christopher Titus's speech, or is that...
It's something like that. Like, his dad was an alcoholic and all that shit, but he never missed a day of work. He always had food in front of him, even if his dad didn't. And it was the same thing with me and my dad, because it's true. He never let me and my sister go hungry.
Yeah, I kind of had problems with my dad for a while there, back when I was in high school, when I was around 16.
We all have problems with our dad. You're one of... Again, well, Tyus, you want to fight your dad when you're 16 years old.
Well...
Not the smartest thing you could ever do.
We had a death in the family, and he really didn't know how to handle it. And he kind of got... It was our mom, so he really didn't know how to handle it. And he kind of got distant there for a few years. But now everything's hunky-dory. Like, the family's kind of... Like, we haven't exactly come together. Like, we don't all live near one another. Like, my dad works out of state. My older brother lives in Georgia, I think. And it's just basically me and my younger brother here taking care of our grandmother. But, you know, it took a long fucking time for the family to recover from that. And I don't blame them. I mean, hell, just looking at how I was back then, like, Jesus fucking Christ. But yeah, I mean, it's just... God, this is a fucking depressing topic.
But I can understand, you know, loss, because... I'm in just assumption here. Your dad was with your mom for, what, 20-something years? Maybe more?
Longer than that, I think. Like, 25, maybe almost 30, 28, something like that.
When I lost my fiance, I'd been with her for 7-8 months, and that almost sent me over the edge. And it was only because I met Doom that I actually kept hanging on. So I do not know how I'd be able to survive if it was like close to 30 years.
Yeah, that's, like I said, that's why I don't really like look at my dad like, you should have been there for us and shit like that. And he had a lot of shit to go through too.
Yeah.
And really, like, my little brother had problems and stuff like that, but we kind of stuck together through all of that. Like, we were kind of each other's anchor for the longest fucking time. So we've got a really good, positive relationship. But it took a while for me and my older brother specifically to reconcile. Like, eventually it took one of those things where I had to just go up to him and be like, look, I know this is coming out of the blue, but back when Mom died, you know, I wasn't really taking into account how you felt and, you know, what you were going through, and we kind of had this animosity thing going on, and I don't want that to be the way that I interact with my older brother. I don't want to leave on that note. I don't want to let that fester. So you're my brother, and I love you, and I'm sorry about how I acted back then. And he was like, no, and he got all serious for a minute, and I'm sorry about the shit that I did too, you know. And then we kind of made up, and we've had the best fucking relationship ever since. So sometimes, kids, it does take you just recognizing that you were a little shit. Yeah. Sometimes it takes recognizing that you were a piece of shit and coming to grips with that, and then apologizing to the people that you were a piece of shit towards.
Oh, God. Worst thing that ever happened around that point as well was the fact that I never told my family that I was seeing someone, and I didn't tell them that I'd gotten engaged to someone. I was planning to tell them by taking my fiance to my sister's engagement party, because it was around the time that she got engaged, and so happy for her. Except that 2 days before the party, the whole incident happened. And so when I got to the party, I was absolutely, I was a little shit. I would just refuse to talk to anyone. I was just off in the corner. And I didn't tell my sister what had happened until a year later at her wedding. where I basically pulled her aside at the reception and just said, hey, look, at your engagement party, I'm sorry that I acted like such a dick, that kind of shit. I'd recently lost my fiance to a heart attack. And the reason that you guys never knew about it is because I was planning to bring her to your party and introduce you and the entire family to her. And again, not make it about us, but make it about you. But she wanted to meet you. And I'm sorry that I acted like such a dick. And like, it honestly, it just, yeah, kind of, kids learn to grow up and be the, you know, be an adult with your siblings. Like, I'm on great terms with my sister now. She's got like, you know, she's just celebrated her 2-year anniversary. It was 2 years yesterday. She's got a 1.5-year old daughter who's a little shit.
Well, tell her your weird friend on the internet said happy anniversary.
Oh, greatest. You want to light this conversation up? I love my niece Sooty so much. Her real name's Lila. We call her Sooty because she's, you know, she's the first one in the family to be born with dark hair. Like my step siblings have fair haired children, and then there's Sooty with black hair. I'm just like, yes, you are the favorite. I love Sooty for so many different reasons. The fact that she, when she was born and when she was sleeping in her crib, she'd always have her arms at like right angles facing up. So they'd go out, straight out, and then right up. So it looks like she was flexing. And then you could push her, like, you could push her arms downwards, and then they'd spring back up in her sleep. So she's like, at 6 months and onwards, when my sister would push her around in a pram at the shopping center, she would grumble at people. She had pram rage, and that was the greatest thing ever, because it's just like, yes, let the anger flow through you, young Sooty. She just like
sitting there like a Sith Lord
at people. I'm just like, soot rage.
Oh god.
And recently I actually bought her I bought her one of the products I make at the bakery, which is just like this sweet dough bun with icing on top and sprinkles. I gave it to her. She ate the entire icing and sprinkles and left the bun. That's how you do shit, kids. That's how you do it.
Hell yeah. Straight gangster.
But the fact is that her,
like, seriously, I can't wait for my brother to have kids. Like, as dumb as I think him wanting to get married is, he's been with this girl for just about as long as I've known you. And she's a very down to earth person, so I don't think, like, she might be the Nawalt kind of, the mythical unicorn Nawalt kind of thing. Mm. But I can't wait for him to have kids so that I can be the fucking cool uncle and come over with like candy and, you know, give them, like, music and shit like that. Like, okay, no, this is AC/DC. You need to listen to this. Fuck that shit that's on the radio now.
Yeah,
listen
no,
to
no, fuck,
here's Metallica.
Fuck the
here's
Slayer.
If you want
real Australian music, go for AC/DC.
Yeah, exactly. Oh, God, I just love AC/DC's music, man. Like, even after Bon Scott died, they just had so much fucking attitude.
Yeah.
They haven't lost a damn thing. I was actually listening to AC/DC before, while you were going to get your car. And, there was one of the videos in the playlist was them live on stage from a few years ago. Like, they're all obviously old men.
Hmm.
But they haven't lost a goddamn thing. Like, they're still out there fucking crushing it. Just absolutely killing it, man. And they had such great attitude in their music.
And it's true, but it's the fact that that's how they were built back then. Like, the fact that AC/DC, like, most of AC/DC and Ozzy Osbourne and the Rolling Stones are still around is because they were built tough.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Now
I mean, Ozzy's kind of fucked up, but I've heard rumors that the reason that he is so fucked up, because like back when the Osbournes was a reality TV show, which was a really fucking bad decision. But and I blame that one on Sharon. But apparently, from what I hear, I don't have any documentation on this, but apparently, he was being fed pills to make him stumble around and fuck up more, because he was funnier when he was on pills. Like, people would be able to laugh at Ozzy. But it wasn't one of those things like, you know, you get a comedian up, like Bill Burr, he does a lot of self-deprecating humor. And he's making fun of himself, but you're laughing with him. It's not like it's just sad and he's being stupid and you're laughing at him. People were laughing at Ozzy. And that's part of the reason that he's so fucked up now, is the Osbournes. Because he did get clean for a long while back then. But Ozzy was fucking crazy, man. Like, that's the dude that fucking snorted ants.
And bit a bat's head off on stage.
That was an accident.
Sorry.
That was an accident.
Oh.
Now, do you know the story behind that
one? No, I don't.
Okay, the way it was supposed to go, I can't remember the song that they were supposed to be playing, but at a certain point in the show, they had big tubs in the ceiling that were meant to deploy at a certain time during this song, and they had rubber bats in them. And Ozzy was going to, like, just pick one of the bats up, one of the rubber bats up on stage and bite its head off like it's a stage gag. And it turns out there were actual bats in the auditorium at the time. And they released the rubber bats, and it freaked out the regular bats, and one of them flew under, and I guess it just, like, got knocked out or whatever by all of the rubber bats, but it landed on stage, and Ozzy picked that one up and bit into it, and didn't realize it until he had killed it.
Shit.
Now, the dove at the record company thing, that was on purpose. That was on purpose. He bit that dove's head off on purpose for a record party. But yeah, he was hanging out like at a hotel with Motley Crue. They talk about this in The Dirt, which is a great book. If anybody ever wants to read the story behind Motley Crue, they probably exaggerate a few things, because I remember them talking about like eating light bulbs backstage and shit just because they could. And I think that some of that shit, because it's autobiographical, so I think some of that shit's a little bit exaggerated. But the story with Ozzy and the ants is documented. Like, they were chilling out at a pool, at a hotel, on tour, and Ozzy wanted a bump. He wanted some coke, and there wasn't any coke around. So he was just like, well, fuck it, I'm just gonna snort these ants. And he got a straw, and there was a line of ants down, like, going to a Mars bar or something like that, and he just snorted up a fucking line of ants. Like, Ozzy was a fucking wild man back in the 80s.
I actually heard that the reason that he survived so long, despite all the drugs and alcohol, is because he's genetically predisposed to be able to survive it. Like, he's evolved to survive this shit. He is the proof.
That's the proof
to creationists that evolution exists. Because if God was around, God would not allow that shit to happen.
Honestly, this is something that I was talking about with my brother. I think I saw like a screen cap of a 4chan post or something on Tumblr. And it was talking about millennials and why millennials are such pussies. And I maintain that they fucking are, despite how much that fucking meme gets, that fucking post gets spread around Tumblr. With that pussy bitch who fucking blocked me. After quote unquote tearing my shit apart, but whatever, that's old news. I think that part of the reason that millennials are such pussies is that there is no cultural bad guy anymore. Like, back in the 70s, you had Alice Cooper, and in the 80s, you had like Slayer and Ozzy. Who, actually, if you listen to Ozzy's music, his stuff is really chill, and it has a really good message. He just looks scary.
Yeah.
Same thing with Alice Cooper, honestly. Well, for a lot of his songs. You know, there are some where he's really fucked up.
Alice Cooper actually hosts a radio show on digital radio in Australia now.
Really?
Yeah, it's, I hear the ad all the time because I still listen to analog radio. We haven't bought a digital radio for work yet. But I listen to the ad all the time. It's just like, greetings, my Australian subjects. It is I, your king, Alice Cooper. I'm like, sure. Sure it is.
Hello, why the hell not?
How are you? How are you today, sir? Good. I'm good as well. Thank you very much.
But there's no... like Marilyn Manson in the 90s. You know, it's like once the 2000s hit, there was no more cultural villain. There wasn't that one guy that people could point to as like the sign, the kind of the physical embodiment of rebellion. So now you get all of these kids who have just, like, they haven't had that figure. So they just kind of do whatever they're told. And they don't know that it's possible to rebel against these things and think for yourself. And because they didn't have an example to follow from. Not one that's as hugely popular as those guys were. Because I remember back in the 90s when I was still going to church, I was a Southern Baptist for the longest fucking time. And Marilyn Manson was the devil. He was the fucking Antichrist. He was the one that everybody was scared of. Like, there was actually a state that paid him not to play there. I'm not even kind of fucking joking. And an entire state somewhere in the Bible Belt was like, look, we'll just pay you to avoid us. But there isn't that kind of figure in pop culture nowadays. It's just like the embodiment of all that is basically Satan.
And so with this announcement, I would like to announce today that we are going to make Jim Fear the next Antichrist.
Okay, I'm down.
Thank you very much.
That'll be fun. Hell yeah.
I will be your manager, because if we're going to make you the Antichrist, we need someone who's going to fuck it up anyway.
That was kind of the point with the podcast anyway. I was just going to become Satan at a certain point.
Eventually, I'm just going to evolve to be Satan.
I just need to get up to the point where I can get on shows like Louder with Crowder and shit like that, and Milo Yiannopoulos' podcast, and then I can truly take my form as the Dark Lord.
Jesus. Oh, fucking... Talking about old music, one of my... And it's a tangent, but one of my favorite Australian comedians is this guy called Adam Hills. And if you ever get the chance to watch any of his live shows or just Adam Hills, it's like he's hilarious because he's given me my philosophy on life. The two shows that I recommend are called Inflatable, which is one of his earlier shows. And then there's one that came out a couple of years ago called Happyism. Now, Inflatable had this really great running joke with it because... It came from a dad joke where there's an inflatable boy, he goes to inflatable school, all the books are inflatable, all the teachers are inflatable, all the students are inflatable, everything's inflatable. So one day he brings a pin to school, he gets sent to the principal's office, and the principal says, you've let me down, you let yourself down, you let the whole school down. Which is a great dad joke, and I'm going to use that at some point on my kids.
What was the guy's name?
Adam Hills. I'll put it in, I'll send Jim... You know, some video information he can put it in the bottom of the podcast.
I'll put it in the description.
Yeah, but and then it came to this point where he talks about a lot of serious matter, and then so he's telling the joke to his imaginary daughter because his 3-month-year-old was just, you know, his daughter was just born. She was about 3 months old at that point, but he imagined her on stage about 7 or 8. He's like, right, so there's an inflatable boy, goes to inflatable school, all the teachers are inflatable, all the students are inflatable, everything's inflatable. Then one day he thinks to himself, well, if everything's inflatable, does that mean the entire world's inflatable? And we can inflate and deflate people as we wish. And then when you inflate people, they stand up stronger and they stand up happier and they seem brighter. And then when you deflate people, they get down lower and they crack, you know, they slump down, they don't feel good. And if you can go through life and inflate as many people as you can, that's how you know you've had a good life. And then he goes on to talk about one of his comedian friends.
So the moral of the story is give blowjobs.
Kinda. But he talks about this comedian friend. She had lovely heart, just wasn't strong enough, and so she passed away. And they're doing a show, a comedy show in Dublin, big comedy festival. And after the show's done, they all go out for drinks. And it's about 5 a.m. when he's walking home, and he gets this amazing sight of the fog rolling in from the sea, and got a beautiful name called the Moors. Should ask Johnny about that shit. But and then he sees people walking up as the sun's rising. People are walking up, and they're looking at him. They double take, and then they smile, and they walk off a bit happier. And it isn't until after the fifth person walks past that he reaches up and realizes he's wearing fucking bunny ears! And it brings him to his point, like the final point for the night. And it's, if you can go through life and inflate as many people as you can, that's how you know you've had a good life. But if you can continue to inflate people even after you've gone, that's how you know you've had a great life. And then all those people you've inflated throughout your life come to inflate you and help you reach heaven. And of course, you know, that's a beautiful thing. Also, if you're going to throw up, eat a Tim Tam, because it tastes the same going down as it does coming back up again. But he also went to talk on about, and bring it back to music, he went to talk on about Jim Morrison.
Oh, and God.
He'd gone through, so the story was he'd gone to Starbucks, and Starbucks sells in exclusive music only for Starbucks, so YouTube, and Bono and that kind of shit. And then he sees an album.
And by the way, this is just a message. Bono, if you're listening, shut up!
No one gives a fuck, Bono!
You dumb fuck!
Every time I clap my hands, a child in Africa dies. And so someone from the back of the stadium stands up and says, then stop clapping your bloody hands!
Bono really is a fucking twat.
Mm. But yeah, so he's in Starbucks, and he sees an exclusive Doors album. Exclusive to Starbucks. Jim Morrison. The Lizard King.
Yeah.
The guy who got kicked off the Ed Sullivan Show for singing Girl Couldn't Get Much Higher. And he's being sold at fucking Starbucks. If you're going to make a if you're going to really do this, you should do it all the way. Make a Morrison mochaccino, sprinkle it with acid, and stir it with your cock. And I love how he says it, because he goes further into it. But it's so hilarious how he rants, and then in Happyism, he actually gave my life's philosophy, which is the belief system of Happyism. And when it was in Australia, it talked about how, because I went to see him live for it before I downloaded the show. Or actually, I should say I bought the show, hint, hint, wink, wink, nudge, nudge, go out and buy the show. Honestly, I'm considering buying the DVD, even though I've got it already. Because just like he needs it, he's worth the money. But he talks about the fact that Australianism has passed on overseas because of people who come to visit Australia. And so he's in Belgium, and he gets a bottle of water. He's out with a whole bunch of friends. He gets a bottle of water. Everyone else gets beer. And the waitress brings him a beer instead of water. And he's like, actually, sorry, I ordered a bottle of water. Oh, no worries, mate. Picks up the bottle of water and walks away. And it's just like, that is the most Australian thing you can hear from someone. No worries. And it's the fact that Australianism is literally being picked up by other cultures because people come over here. So if any Australians are listening and you see someone come to Australia, teach them as much Australian slang as you can so they can get, they can go home and start using it and seeing multiculturalism. But Happyism is basically the belief system that you should do something as long as it makes you happy. And it's not like going out and killing someone. It's just like, do things that make you feel happy inside. And it came down to this, he's in the hospital with his grandfather, who was 90 years old at the time, who dying of leukemia. And if you die of leukemia, it's the worst possible way to die, because you die without dignity. That's just my own personal belief. But they look out this window and they see this old man riding down the street on a bicycle with his, like, not holding onto the handlebars, the arms spread out wide, just accepting life. And that's how he wants to be. He wants just to be happy in the world. And he has the greatest phrase for a tagline of Happyism. It came from the fact that in the Montreal Comedy Festival, when it was hosted by the Muppets, he got invited. And so basically they said, look, we just need to check over your material to make sure it's okay for the show because we can't allow certain jokes. So he sends him material and it's like, everything's okay except this one joke. And it was about, it was about, I think, cancer patients and the Holocaust or some shit like that. It comes up and yeah, it's a very dark joke. And then he gets upset and he's just like, I'm not going to go on the fucking Muppet Show then. I'm not going to go to the Montreal Comedy Festival. I'm not going to meet them because fuck them. It's my joke. He got really pissy about it until one of his friends, who's this big fucking 300-pound biker in leather, you know, he's at the bar with him and he's just like, wait, so if you take out this joke, you get to go on the Montreal Comedy Festival. Uh-huh. And if you go to the Montreal Comedy Festival, you get to meet the Muppets. Uh-huh. And that means you might get a chance to meet Kermit the Frog. Uh-huh. And if you get to meet Kermit the Frog, you get to touch Kermit the Frog and shake his hand. Uh-huh. And he gave me, this is the word to Van Hills, he gave me the greatest affirmation that I've ever heard before. Touch the fucking frog. Which is the most epic thing ever. Literally, go out and touch the fucking frog. You which is, so that's the tagline for the religion of happyism. Go out and touch the fucking frog. Do shit that makes you feel happy in the simplest way possible. Find happiness in the littlest things. But he's the most fucking hilarious thing ever because he has a show in England called The Last Leg or some shit like that, and talks about, it's a talk show, but it's got people with disabilities on it as well. Like Adam Hills was born without a right foot. He doesn't have a right foot.
Holy shit.
Yeah, no, he has a prosthetic, and he actually made a joke once, just like, every time he gets picked up by cops, they check to see if his right foot's on. She's like, well, how am I going to go driving? I can't really walk out of the house not having my right foot on. It's pretty damn obvious it's not there. But if you've ever seen it on YouTube or just pictures of it, or GIFs, where he goes on a huge tangent about Joan Rivers, who made a comment about Adele. Like, he absolutely tears into her. He's just like, you want... Like, how fucking dare you say shit like that? Because Joan Rivers made fun of Adele for being fat. It's like, you who keeps fucking changing your appearance every 5 fucking years, that has more plastic in you than a Tupperware party. If my daughter wanted to grow up and be like Adele, that's a great thing. If she wanted to grow up and be like you, I'd send her a fucking psychologist. Like, he tore into her.
Jesus Christ. It sounds like she fucking deserved it. I don't know about the whole
thing. She did, because you're just like, she was like, oh, you know, Adele. And she's like, and puffs out her cheeks and, you know, put down the fork a bit. It's like, no, fuck off, you bitch. You are literally, there's no part about you that is real anymore. But yeah, Adam Hills is like one of Like, there's a whole bunch of Australian comedians that I could recommend. Like, Adam Hills, Will Anderson, Carl Barron. Carl Barron is hilarious simply because he's so fucking, he's not big. Like, American comedians, just like, they'll run out of Australia and be like, hey, how you going, guys? Oh, okay, yeah. So I was at Starbucks the other week, and, you know, guys like Starbucks. Woo, yeah, we love Starbucks. Carl Barron walks out and he starts every show he does like this. He walks out, gets in front of the mic, and it's just like, when the applause stops, it's like, how you going? He's literally so fucking unhyped. It's not funny, but he's the greatest fucking comedian ever.
All right. What's his name?
Carl Barron. I'll write that one down for you as well.
Carl Barren, like barren landscape?
B-A-R-R-O-N.
Barren, okay.
And, it was like he was talking to a psychologist one day, and it's just like, so, what's your dad like? Annoying people. No, what's his personality like? He's an asshole. Do you think you and your dad have anything in common? Yeah, our last name. Well, how do you find your dad? Easy. Dad! It's so fucking hilarious. I love him, because Australian comedians have the Australian sense of humour, where we'll take the piss out of everything.
Which is one of the best things about Australia, honestly, is your sense of humour. That's definitely one of my favourite things about Australia.
Yeah. Cause not...
I still have to actually show up to the fucking country, because I read... If you just got your Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy omnibus thing.
Yeah.
You need to get So Long and Thanks for All the Fish.
Yeah, it's in here. Let's see what page it's on.
No. Not So Long and Thanks for All the Fish. It was, hang on, I'm gonna actually have to look it up, because there's a Douglas Adams book out there that is one of his, let me go to his Wikipedia page, that'll be the easiest place to find it. Oh yeah, that's right, he actually did, yeah, he played with Procol Harum and Pink Floyd. Here we go. Not the meaning of Lyft, and the deeper meaning of Lyft. Which is great. That's one of the best things that's ever come out of Douglas Adams' mind. Him and a friend just wrote down, they took a bunch of English town names, like just random town names in Britain, and they took feelings that did not have specific names for them, and gave them words for them that were these town names. So, like, that feeling of walking into a room and not remembering what you came in there for is called walking.
There's a creepypasta about that.
You did, didn't you?
Yeah, no, there's psychological vampires. And I'm just like, no, psychological vampires is what Twilight had. Because after seeing it, you want to be psychologically brain dead.
Oh God! No, there was a novel. It wasn't a novel. It was like a collection of Douglas Adams books. Can I get, where's his bibliography?
Be down the bottom.
Works. Here we go. Dr. Snuggles, The City of Death, Hitchhiker's Shada, Restaurant, Life, the Universe, and Everything. So Long and Thanks for All the Fish. The Radio Scripts. A Christmas Fairly Story. Bureaucracy. Long Dark Tea Time of the Soul. Mostly Harmless. Starship Titanic is just... Well, it was written by Terry Jones, but it's not... Salmon of Doubt. That was it. The Salmon of Doubt. It's 11 chapters of an unfinished manuscript. That was basically going to tie in the Dirk Gently detective novels into The Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. And it's also a bunch of just like random shit that he had lying in a drawer, or articles that he wrote for just random magazines throughout his life. Like he got one of the first Blackberries. That, you know, you could, like, you had to type with your thumbs, and he was going on about how fucking amazing this piece of technology, like, he was like a kid in a candy store. He was going on about how amazing this piece of technology is, and he lets you know that he's actually writing this with his thumbs from the bathtub. Like, he's taking a bath and writing this article about how awesome this piece of technology is. And he has a rant in there about how everything needs to be on a standardized power source, so we don't have to worry about the big black dongly things anymore. But, God, there was one particular thing I was about to tell you about from that. Because you had brought up something that reminded me of it, but it's The Salmon of Doubt is just great. It's got a lot of like Douglas Adams philosophy and how he went about his life and how he kind of viewed things. And it's not like you have to infer from his fiction writings. You can actually get like how he views the world from the horse's mouth. And I really, really want to do narrations of so much stuff out of that, just because it would be so much fucking fun.
but I'm never going to get permission to do it.
Why not?
Fuck it. I should just write his estate. I should just email his estate. Just email his wife. Be like, look, I really, really love your husband's novels and his work, and I've been a fan since I was in high school, and I'm a narrator. I do audiobooks and stuff like that, and I really want to do some of his stuff from Salmon of Doubt, because there's a lot of wisdom in that book that a lot of people could benefit
from. No. We're not going to do the Salmon of Doubt. We're going to do the entirety. No. We'll pitch...
Do the whole Hitchhiker's Guide series.
Whole thing, all right? We'll pitch it to Doom. We'll use, like, Laughly Dapper funds to make a donation to his estate. We're just like, we don't want to do it for profit. We just want to do it because we love his work so much. And you let me play Marvin.
I think we could do that. If we do it, then it'll probably go under Dramatically Dapper anyway. Yeah, so, yeah. That means that I have final say. So yes, Crow plays Marvin.
Yeah, it's just
I get to play.
Yes,
Ford.
You get to play Ford, but play it's just Ford. Like I've got a terrible.
Ford is my favorite fucking character in the series. I can do a really.
I've got
good
a terrible pain in all the diodes down my left side.
Guess which ones have never been replaced.
Oh shit.
It's incredible how much of my life philosophy actually comes from Douglas Adams. Like, one of the best lines in the entire series is in Mostly Harmless, when they finally get back to Earth, when they're chasing Random. Yeah. And Ford Prefect has a credit card with infinite credit on it from the Hitchhiker's Guide offices because he hacked the central mainframe. And, he's ordering literally everything. Like, he buys the London Zoo and tells them to release the animals. And then he goes on to rooms. Like, he does this all from room service at their hotel. He just picks up the phone in the hotel room and is like, no, yeah, I want to buy the whole fucking thing. The whole zoo. And then he gets them to bring them foie gras. Foie gras. Which, I'm not sure how foie gras is made.
Goose liver.
But apparently it is bad. Yeah, it's like, it's not really good for geese. And then, Arthur brings up that, you know, well, I always thought foie gras was kind of mean. And Ford's like, what? He goes, well, I always felt bad for the geese. And then Ford says, and this was one of the most profound things in any of the books that he ever wrote. This one line. Sod the geese. You can't care about every damn thing. And that really is something that a lot of people have to come to grips with. Like, people on Tumblr would do good to adopt that one. It basically proves why intersectional feminism is bullshit. Like, there's just so much wisdom packed into sod the geese, you can't care about every damn thing. Because you can't. You're going to burn yourself out. And if you try to care about everything and fix everything, you're going to wind up doing nothing and making the world a worse place.
Because if you try to care, if you try to fix everything, something's going to... fuck, what's the word? Like, cancel out. Like, greatest line I ever heard was from... not from Douglas Adams, but it was the original Adams Family. What's perfect for the spider is chaos for the fly. You can't fix everything in this world.
It's kind of like an experience is subjective kind of thing.
Yeah. So you can try your hardest to fix everything, but you can't make everyone happy.
Because everybody's always going to find something to complain about.
Trust me, with Tumblr on his hands.
Oh, God. I'm honestly kind of shocked I don't get more hate mail on Tumblr than I do.
Give me a week. I'm being kind of busy.
No, it can't come from you, because then it won't be real. Like,
it won't be hate. Oh, just like, your hair is too sexy. That's some hate mail.
Like, I know it, baby.
Shut up, baby. I know it.
I was honestly loving it when that millennial post started getting passed around, because I had just started my job when that shit happened, and every night, and this is like kind of proves to me how weak people on Tumblr are, because every day I would wake up in the morning and I would just like check, I would check my shit before I went into work, like I would check my social media stuff, like see if anybody sent me anything on Twitter or mentioned me on Tumblr or whatever. And I would have messages, and I would go through and I would read all of these messages. It's like, go die, you're stupid. You know, all of this dumb shit. And then I would just be laughing about it all day. And then I would get home, and I would get myself a nice big glass of beer or whatever. And I would just, like, have fun with these fucking idiots. Just these fucking cowards that come into my inbox. The best ones, though, were the people who actually owned up to what they said that didn't turn on and on. Those were the most fun. Because they were serious, and you could tell that they were serious. Because Anon was enabled, yeah. They could have used it, but they didn't. I actually have a little bit of respect for those people, because at least they owned their shit.
Mm-mm.
But I don't get those people who are like, oh my god, it's so bad, these words on the internet are hurting me. Just like, well,
your words hurt me.
Yeah, like, were you and I the only ones that grew up with sticks and stones?
You know, well, Australians grew up with chopperine, and it's just like, harden the fuck up. Wait, which is the funny thing, it's just like, because, alright, it didn't come from the original Chopper Reed, it came from a guy doing a parody of Chopper Reed, but it's still the greatest thing, because it's like, you know, this is Max. He owns a four-wheel drive, but he never goes out into the country. He just drives around the city. Harden the fuck up, Max. This is Laura, and she has a therapist for her dog. You know what Dr. Chopper says? Harden the fuck up, Lauren. This is Aurelio, and he drinks soy milk in his latte. How about you have a nice steaming cup of harden the fuck up, Aurelio?
Anybody this who puts milk in their fucking coffee is wrong. Wrong. You are, if you put milk in your coffee, no, if you put milk in your coffee, you are wrong. You need to use cream.
I don't use dairy. Just like, this is Timmy, and he can't go on a family vacation. He can't go on a family vacation without a portable handheld gaming console. Harden the fuck up, Timmy. And just like, it's this 10-year-old kid, and he just like starts crying. He's just like, oh, it's okay. And the greatest thing is just like, this is Stefan. His name is Stefan. Harden the fuck up, Stefan. And then he gets this guy, typical Australian, like wearing flannelette, fucking a Cobra hat, missing an arm, just like, this is Bevan. He owns a big dog, sleeps with his Bowie knife, and once cut off his own arm for a bet. Fucking spot on, Bevan. And he, like, there are so many videos out there that he's actually done a comedy show. But it's so hilarious fucking watching this guy, because he actually met the real Chopper Reed and he pissed himself. Because it's like, how do I explain it? It's like if I dressed up like Thanos, you know, and acted like a big son of a bitch, and then actually meeting Thanos, I'd be dead. Dead in seconds. Motherfucking dead.
Oh, yeah.
But that's how I grew up. And it's like back, and I don't want to sound like one of those fucking inspirational quotes from back in the day, but it's like, back when I was a fucking kid, you know, we stayed out until it was pitch black darkness and the streetlights came on.
Yeah.
And we learned not to get into cars with strangers. To the point where if that shit happens, well, I mean,
after the first kid gets abducted, it's just natural selection.
Yeah.
The dumb ones kind of deserved it. They didn't learn as quick as the other kid.
Yeah, it's just like, if you're dumb enough to get into a car, then you're dumb enough to fucking stay there. the fact that it's like, you know, we learnt our fucking lesson. You know, don't do stupid shit and you'll survive. Because now you gotta fucking helicopter your parent, your children, you gotta fucking wrap them in bubble wrap, because you can't let anything hurt them. It's just like, no, let them fucking get hurt.
Oh, God, there's the neighborhood that I live in, it's pretty close. Like, it's three or four roads with one connecting road going down the middle. And, like, two main-ish roads on the side. It all kind of connects to the highway. But there's a state park, like, I don't know, probably a mile and a half, 2 miles from my house. And, like, back when I was a kid, we could walk down to the state park. It was just, like, it was right down the road. We could just, like, walk down there. We're out in the country, you know, we didn't really... Well, we're not really, like, out in the country. We're barely outside of the city limits. But, you know, we didn't have to worry about shit. We could just, like, walk down to the state park, chill out, come home. We could run around the neighborhood all we wanted, like, 2-3 blocks, you know. We used to do that shit all of the time. We would, we lived, like, 3-4 blocks over from our grandmother's house, so we would just, like, come over to our grandmother's house and hang out with our cousins and shit like that. You can't do that shit nowadays. Like, our parents would be arrested nowadays if they let us fucking do that, and word got out.
Yeah. And it's like, you know, back when I was a kid, fucking, oh, greatest thing ever, because when I used to walk to school, there was a fucking huge-ass dog that used to run to the gate every morning and just snarl and snap and try to, you know, kill me. And I didn't know what to do. And my dad says, look, you got to deal with it yourself, because you'll never grow up to be a man without it. And I'm just like, you're right, Dad. So one day on the way to school, I grabbed a huge stick. Okay. No, I didn't hit the dog. I would never hit a dog that didn't deserve it. That actually brings me into another story, but... The dog came running up, and I just, before it hit the fence, I just took the stick and bashed it against the fence just as it was about to hit, and it reeled back a little bit, and we just had this staring contest, and I'm just like, no, down. And ever since that point, it had run up to the fence, see me, and then stop, and I actually got on good terms with it, because I stopped being fucking afraid. It's just like, no, you stay down, right? We're equals at this point, because I get beaten by my dad, and I'm sure that your owner beats you, senseless. But, I used to have a friend who had a German Shepherd, black German Shepherd, big-ass motherfucker. And this dog was aggressive. This dog was, you know, was shitly trained. And I stand by the fact that there is no bad dogs, only bad owners.
Oh, yeah,
this
definitely.
This dog was trained horribly, to the point where it always used to try to bite me. One day I went around to his place, he wasn't there, but his side gate was open and his dog got out. The dog bit my foot, bit through solid leather boots and into my skin. So what did I do? Freaking the fuck out as I was? I kicked him with the other foot, and I kicked him hard to the point where I broke his fucking jaw.
Damn.
Yeah, because a kid's freaking out. You do not... Like, he bit into my left foot and I just kicked with the right. So when I went to see him the next day, he's like, oh yeah, the dog got out, must have got hit by a car because his jaw's kind of fucked up, we had to put him down. And I did not feel remorse for that shit.
Damn.
But and like, biggest argument I've ever had with anyone was actually 2 weeks before I started dating Carney, which was hilarious. But I was doing volunteer work on this scenic railway through the mountains of my state. And it's a beautiful thing. Only steam engine of its kind in Australia. If you ever get the chance to go see it, Puffing Billy. Sounds really mean, but it's a wonderful journey. And I met this girl who was into creepypasta narrators. And she's like, oh yeah, you probably haven't heard of him, but it's like this guy called Mr. Creepypasta. And I'm like, oh, so you know Spike? She's like, what? I'm like, yeah, Spike, I've worked with him before. And I was kind of bullshitting out of my ass with most of this shit. Like, at this point, I'd never really worked with Spike. I just knew him.
Yeah.
I'm like, yeah, nah, I know him. She's like, you know him? I'm like, yeah, no, I'm a narrator too. And we had this huge, well, I don't want to say argument, but like debate over punishing your children, like physically punishing your children. And I stand by the fact my dad hit me as a kid. And I grew up okay. He only
like
had
what do you mean? What do you mean by hit? Like physical discipline or like abuse? Because there is a difference.
Physical discipline. He never abused me once. My dad hates that I bring it up, but it's true, because he only had to ever hit me twice, and that was when I did something that would have killed me, and I didn't learn. He's never abused me. He's only physically disciplined me twice, and I learned, because after I calmed down from crying and being a little bitch, he'd come into my room, and he'd sit down next to me, and he'd tell me what I did wrong, which is where, you know, people go wrong, because they just think you hit your kids and you hope they learn. My dad told me what I did wrong, told me that he didn't, you know, he never stopped loving me no matter what, and the fact is I have to learn these things. And I did, because I was able to say, well, if it's true, if what I've done is wrong, I don't want to do it again, because he's explained to me what would happen if he didn't stop me.
Yeah, my parents were the same way. I got physically disciplined as a kid, and I'm a totally fucked up person. I freely admit how fucked up I am. But I think that was part of what brought me around to being marginally okay. Like, being able to deal with the fucked upness. The fucked upness comes from a whole bunch of other shit. The physical discipline actually kind of straightened me out on a few things. Like I said, we were Southern Baptists, so we would go to church 3 times a week. It was Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night. We would be in fucking church. And me and my cousins, and, like, we would all go to the same fucking church. And I would cut up. Like, there was one time I brought my, a friend to church with me. And we sat there during the sermon, and we just, like, we were being little shits. Just, like, loud and obnoxious and interrupting, and, like, we weren't, like, trying to talk over the pastor or anything like that. We were just involved, we were in our own little world, and we didn't realize how our little world was affecting everybody else. And my mom was up in the, she was up in the choir, which was back behind the pastor. And she got up out of the choir seats, left the, I don't know what you'd fucking call it, the sanctuary or whatever it is, the big room where the I'm forgetting all of my words now, where the sermons happen. And she left, and then she went and put up her choir robes and came back out and sat down next to me. And I knew I was in fucking trouble. I knew I was in deep fucking trouble. Because she didn't say a fucking word. She didn't look at me. She just sat down next to me. And that was it. Like, there was no more acting up in church. But then we got home, and she beat the shit out of me. Like, I mean, she got Dad's belt down. Like, Dad didn't even... Like, usually the way it went is if... my ma wasn't shy about using the belt. But, if I did something fucked up while Dad was gone, I would get a spanking from my mom, and then Dad would come home and I would get a spanking for him, so it was kind of a double reinforcement. Dad didn't even feel the need to fucking touch me. I couldn't sit down for a day. And that, I never fucking acted up in church again. Never. Not once. And I understand why. Like, even back then, I understood why, because I was being obnoxious, I was distracting people, I was interrupting, being a little shit, you know, and without that physical discipline, I don't think I would have gotten it as well as I did. Yeah. And now I kind of have that where you're in a public place, like, recently, a year or so ago, I went to a funeral with a buddy of mine for a mutual friend's mother or grandmother or something like that. And the pastor was a dick, like an absolute total dick. Like, he didn't know any of the people there. They had just hired this guy to do the service. And then they were going to have the thing. And it was so fake, and everybody fucking knew it. And it personally offended me, because this was also back when I was big in my like prick atheist phase. And it just, like, if this had happened, like, 2 years, 3 years earlier, I would have just gone full Hitchens on this motherfucker. Just stood up and been like, why the fuck are you up here? What the fuck do you know about anything? Let's have one of these good people come up here and talk to us about the deceased. I don't know this lady. I don't know any of these people except for, you know, her name was Brooke. I don't know any of these people except for Brooke. But I know that you're not the right guy for this fucking job. I just would have been an absolute asshole. But because I had that discipline, I knew that that wasn't the fucking time. And that I need to sit down and shut up and just let this kind of happen. This isn't my place to do this kind of thing. And sometimes it takes years for that kind of lesson to kind of cement itself in people's heads, you know? But I don't think there's necessarily anything wrong with physical discipline as long as what was wrong is explained to the child being disciplined. Because my parents did that thing too. They were like, okay, like, they would do the spanking, break off, everybody go calm down, and then they would come back and be like, okay, do you understand why that happened? And then we would go through and talk it out, and they would explain to me why I got my ass beat. And, you know, it's all about the explanation. Look, there's this guy on YouTube, and he has his own website, Stefan Molyneux. He's on Free Domain Radio, which I recommend looking up his podcast. He's a very intelligent guy. He's had a lot of experience in life. He's kind of like the internet's dad kind of thing. But he's got this thing called peaceful parenting, where he doesn't advocate ever laying a hand on your children in anger or in discipline. Just explaining to them. And he brought up, like, the example that he used was his daughter didn't want to brush her teeth. Like, young kid, like 4 or 5, didn't want to brush her teeth. So he was like, okay, fine. You know what? You can just go to bed. You don't have to brush your teeth tonight. That's fine. I'll just step back from this. And it's not an undermining of my parental authority. We're just not going to argue about this right now. And then the next day he came to her and he's like, okay, I'm going to explain to you why you need to brush your teeth. And he like took her and showed her pictures of cavities and explained what like sugar and everything does to your teeth. And
the big book of British smiles.
Yeah. Yeah. Give her the big book of British smiles. And now she brushes her teeth. No problem. So I don't know. Like the peaceful parenting thing doesn't seem like a necessarily bad idea to me. I'm just a little bit skeptical because I come from that school of very much Robert Heinlein. Like, if you read Starship Troopers, he lays out why you're supposed to spank your children. And basically he compares human kids to puppies. And like, if a puppy pisses on the carpet, you have to rub the puppy's nose in it. You have to catch them when they do it. You have to rub the puppy's nose in it. And then you have to physically discipline them so they know what they did was wrong, because they don't have the mental capacity at that age to understand why what they were doing was wrong. And I think that's kind of an argument for corporal punishment, but I don't know. It's just one of those things that I'm having to kind of turn over in my mind.
Lucky that you're too big for me to spank you. I'm like, no, Mum, you're lucky because I'm old enough now to know that if you try doing that, I'm just going to start screaming, oh, yes, harder, harder! She's like, I never want to hear that from you again. I'm like, well, don't try to threaten me with a spanking. Like, the worst weapon that ever came out of us, like, and I don't know if this is just Australians that got it, but the wooden spoon. The wooden spoon was like, it went from like the hand, the wooden spoon, and then the belt. And then what was worse, what we found out in the middle of the belt and the wooden spoon was the hold spoon, which was a wooden spoon with holes in it that you'd stir like pasta with. Except that it was big and huge flat surface area with holes in it. So no fucking wind resistance.
Yeah. Yeah. My grandma used to do something like that. My grandma on my mother's side, she used to have a plant out out of her back door. It was like you walked out the back door, you stood on the top step, and reached to your left. Like, just put your arm out to the left, and your hand was in this bush. And it had these long, thin, not vines, but, like, branches. Really long, thin, kind of supple branches to it. And whenever we did something wrong over at her house, because we would always go and spend time over there and hang out with her and shit like that. But whenever we did something wrong over there, she would be like, all right, go pick out a switch.
Ah, shit.
And then we would just immediately start crying because we knew we was about to get it. But she would make us go out there and pick out a switch and clean all of the leaves off of it and then give it to her, and she would use that to whoop us with. And it didn't like actually physically hurt us. Like, it left like little red marks, not even bruises. Like, you know, this will clear up in an hour. It just stung. But it was that psychological thing, man, of, oh god, I'm gonna have to go out and I'm gonna have to pick out my own fucking, like, it's like, all right, sir, you're about to kill me with. Yeah, you're about to face execution. Do you want to go with the hangman's noose? Do you want to be electrocuted? Do you want us to guillotine your fucking head off? You know?
I'll take drowning in naked ladies, thanks.
Yeah, and you had to pick a good one, too, or she'd go out there and pick her one. And she would always reach, like, into the middle of the bush and pick out one of those good, long, thick ones.
Yeah, that old crone pick out the fucking tree and just like, all right, it's a whooping time.
She would, man. She lived to be, like, 98 years old. She smoked, like, 3 packs of Winston's a day. I have no idea how she fucking lived that long.
Death was afraid.
Yeah. Yeah.
No. you need to understand. She fucking scares me.
Grandma was fucking hard, dude. She was also a brilliant fucking cook. Like, the one thing that really pisses me off about when she died was she had this recipe for a mustard-based... It wasn't hot sauce. It was like gravy. It was like a mustard-based gravy. And we would always get it every Thanksgiving, every Christmas. And it was so delicious. It was just like heaven in a fucking cup that you would just put this on your turkey, boom. You're in the afterlife. But she always made it from memory. And she never wrote the recipe down. And after she died, my aunts would, like, they would all come together and try to recreate this sauce. Like, they would get together with my mom and they would try to recreate the sauce. And none of them could ever do it. They never got it right. And it's just gone. It's just fucking gone forever. And that still fucking keeps me up some nights. That I'm never gonna fucking get to taste that again. So, kids, get your fucking grandparents to write down that recipe you like and give it to you, and like post it on the internet or something.
Yes, give us your grandma's recipe.
Yeah, seriously. No, I'm being dead fucking serious. Post your grandma's favorite recipes in the comments section. Like, if you're listening to this on iTunes, if we're up on iTunes by the time that this goes up, then fucking post your grandma's favorite recipes in the comment section. I will make that shit and tell you how good it is.
Alright, so Grandma Scarecrow's recipe for a Thanksgiving dinner. You take 1 part whiskey to 10 parts whiskey. No, greatest thing... Alright, so my dad's mother... My dad's mother was badass. Like, my grandma was the serious epitome of, like, if I can get to her level of being a badass, I would love that. She was out at a pub one night with my granddad, you know, drinking, and this big fucking biker comes through. And he sits down at the bar and starts making a ruckus. And what does my fucking grandma do? She goes up and she bashes his head in with a bottle.
Damn.
Grandma was badass. Right? Like, she's the reason my
Grammy
dad is...
Scarecrow was a motherfucker.
Yeah, no. She's the reason that my dad is deaf in one ear, because she whooped his ass so hard he went deaf.
Damn.
But the funny thing is that, like, she...
I wonder what he fucking did.
Oh, he was a little shit. Like all Scarecrow children, he's a little shit. But before she passed away, she had, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, maybe 6 grandchildren. I was just born, like I was a year and a half, either 6 months old or a year and a half old when she passed away in a car accident. But she, like, when she was around the grandkids, she was the epitome of being a grandma. She was baking cookies and sweetest old lady you've ever met. And it honestly breaks my heart that I don't remember anything about her. But it hurts me more because I've got at least two cousins who never got to meet her because they were way too young. But and then recently in Scarecrow family history, we found out that my granddad, dad's dad, has been diagnosed with, I think, prostate cancer. And it's not moving anywhere, so it's not something for us to be worried about in the immediate future. But it's there, and he wanted us to know. So it's just like, it kind of woke me up. It's just like, well, they're all, you know, old people are dying. I've got to start making time to go see them.
Yeah.
Damn old people.
Well, we've been going on for about 3 hours, so let's find a happy place to end this on, because I don't want to leave everybody out. Oh, like all our family members are dead or dying. And
oh,
kind of
shit, you know what we should do?
So,
professional differences.
Yes, we were going to do that, weren't we?
Oh, yes. Yes. I kind of forgot the voice.
So, guys, the exceptional Barnabas Deimos, who is a brilliant writer, and you should all go read his stuff, has given me permission to produce 3 more of his stories, because I Still Love You is one of Barney's stories. But one of them is Professional Differences, which he did with Vox Per Nox way back in the day. And if you don't know who Vox Per Nox is, I don't blame you, but you're shortchanging yourself. Go look up Vox Per Nox, VoxPernox on YouTube, and listen to all of his shit and download it and fucking mirror it and shit like that. He disappeared. He doesn't update anymore, but his shit is good. Like, this dude is the kind of voice actor that we all aspire to be. He was brilliant. But Barney has given me permission to produce a narration of Professional Differences. And I chose Crow to be my interlocutor with this one, because Crow does crazy really, really good. Like, if you go and listen to the support group for serial killers and psychopaths up on this channel, it'll also be coming out on the iTunes, which if everything goes as planned, that'll be in the feed way sooner than this episode will. But, yeah, we figured that we would give you guys kind of a sneak peek pre-production and just kind of do this here on the podcast as a special treat for you guys while I've got Wandering Scarecrow here. So.
Hold on, let me get...
You ready to go?
Let me just get lubricated. Gotta remember, because the voice I use now is not going to be the voice that I use in the full production. I still have to find voice. This one's just for shits and giggles.
Yeah, this is just for shits and giggles. So I'm going to be using pretty much the voice that I'm using in the real narration. But this is just going to kind of be for fun, because I'm really drunk and I'm assuming that Crow's had a few.
Yeah, 4 or 5.
So we're just gonna have some fun with this. So, all right, this is a very unprofessional rendition of Professional Differences by Barnabas Deimos. Hello.
Hi.
You can't fucking pull that shit on me.
I will break you.
You're fucking trying.
So, you're still quite chipper and overindulgent of your emotions still?
Oh, of course! Can't you see from my smile? And you! Aren't we always the man of too many words to say something simple?
Perhaps my vocabulary can be toned. Hang on, I should put on a silly voice too, because you're doing a silly voice. Perhaps my vocabulary can be toned down a bit, but regardless of what you think, this is how I talk. Same as in regards to how you act. Speaking of acting, I saw your little enactment on the news. Care to explain yourself there?
Why are you worried that you're going to be caught? Big Back McHale getting caught?
Oh, hardly, honey. I worry, however, that your antics will cause an uproar. While it may lead to your eventual discovery, it will most likely intrude on my work, making it slower, if not forcing me into hiatus for a time.
See? Told ya, you're gonna get caught, you're gonna get caught. Me? I wanna get caught. I wanna get it all out in the open. Oh, yeah, out in the open, boy. I wanted it to be big, really big.
Your penchant for the dramatic is always amusing, Victor. But you really do have to think about the things in the long run. I understand your love of being a gibbering nihilist can get in the way of your foresight. But if you get caught in one large fell swoop of an event, you won't be able to continue the work.
What's your point?
Let's consider this, shall we? This is my most recent work. Notice no cuts, no destructive contusions, or shows of blunt trauma. As a matter of fact, I might say he is rather content and happy in his repose.
Ooh, I love show and tell's days! Looky what I did myself. Notice the... you can't notice much.
No, you can't. What exactly did you do?
Well, I snuck into the garage, snuck into the bedroom, snuck into the bathroom for a moment, and rubbed up along my fish bladder.
There, you killed two at once?
Technically three.
You disgust me. Why I continue this with you, I don't know. I would get far more work done without indulging your childlike need for show and tell.
Oh, you know why we continue this, Mickey. If you don't, you lose sight of me. And you get to keep tabs on me to make sure that I don't go too far. Plus, you love me.
Oh, you know Victory. It, honey.
Victory and Mickey sitting in a tree. K-I-L-L-I-N. How does that keep going?
G, I believe. Ever astute in your mad clarity. And stop dancing on him. I need to return the body prior to his wife returning from cuckolding him.
Cuckold? What? He's been making cuckoo clocks?
Cheating on him. She'll return and think that he died of a sudden onset of congestive heart failure that his family suffers from. She will return to the embrace of her lover afterwards, whom she has not done her research on. Based upon his violent past, he will most likely beat her. After a few incidents of domestic abuse, I will arrive and take care of her and him in my own way. In this case, an attempted murder on his part and self-defense on hers will suffice.
Uh-huh. Well, don't you have it all planned out? Unless, of course, some jerk did this!
Congratulations. You've contaminated my work of art with your immature sanguine finger painting. A smiley face on his peaceful countenance. How droll.
No one appreciates my art.
And no one appreciates the meticulousness it takes to ensure that a corpse appears to have died of one malady as opposed to malevolence. Skilled hands and a far less excitable personality.
You say what? You insult me?
I will shove a cherry bomb so far up your ass and make you watch Bambi's mother death scene over and over and over again until you apologize.
Case in point.
I should have strangled you in the womb.
Oh, please, honey. Your stubby digits at the time wouldn't have been able to perform the gesticulating motions.
You know what I mean! But you're my brother, and I have to love you because Mom says so.
Yes, of course. You have to be strong for Mother. Love is the tie that binds, but that won't stop me from turning you in or killing you myself if need be. Now calm your chaotic work and attempt to do some more planning and forethought.
Yeah, sure.
Spoil part.
Good. Now I have to return the corpse, go home, and prep for the day ahead. Perhaps make an appearance at my office, since I will have to receive news of one of my patients passing away of heart failure. So sad. So sad.
Ta-ta! Bye-bye now! See you later! Give my best to Barbara! Is he gone? Are they all gone yet?
Oh, yeah, he's gone. It's just you and me now, boy. Just you kidding me. Can be my sweet Variola Major. What's that? You want me to share you with the world? But I'll get jealous. Okay, let's compromise. I get to pick all the lovely people I get to share you with. But of course, in the end, you and me will be together forever and ever.
And that was Professional Differences by Barnabas Deimos, and we butchered the fuck out of that, and I'm definitely sending this to Barney.
Yeah, just like, Barney, this is what we did. It's ready, it's perfect, we know it's better than yours. Just like, at the end, just add, please don't kill us.
No, I'm just going to send him the podcast with a timestamp. But, yeah, okay, so we've been going on for almost 3 hours and 10 minutes here, so I think we're going to go ahead and cut it here, folks. I would like to thank you, Wandering Scarecrow, for coming on the podcast. It was a hell of a lot of fun.
It was.
And you guys out there can find his information down in the show notes. You should totally go follow him on YouTube and Tumblr. Do you have anything else that you want people to follow you on? Go ahead and plug your shit.
You can follow my car. It's a white Hilux with a black tailgate. I don't know how far you'll get. I drive kind of erratically. You can try to follow my sister, but she'll probably kill you.
Okay, and there is for my dumbass, there is the YouTube, the Tumblr, the Bandcamp, and Twitter. Go ahead and hit me up, guys. I love talking to you fuckers, you crazy glorious bastards. And when we are up on iTunes, I will release a special video letting all of you guys know, so keep an eye out for that. I'm just waiting to hear back from the iTunes folks. For those of you who use inferior platforms like Stitcher and whatever the hell else, I will work on getting it up there too. I'm trying to get it out as many places as possible. But yeah, thank you guys very much for tuning in and taking time out of your finite lives to listen to the drunken ramblings of two assholes.
And we really do appreciate it. So go check out all of the lovely links down in the description or in the show notes if you're listening to this on iTunes or wherever. And we thank all you guys for tuning in. And we will see you guys later. Peace out, everybody.
See you guys.